Testando, testando. Um, dois, testando.
Bom dia, Murilo.
Bom dia, professor. Tudo bem?
Tudo bem? Oh, você quer partilhar a apresentação com a gente? Não sei se vai funcionar, mas
Como assim, professor?
se a gente fica com o
Ah,
comando da tela também.
claro, claro. Deixa eu colocar o senhor como administrador, né? Perfeito.
Hora que o Derek entrar, quem sabe colocar ele também, né?
Perfeito, perfeito. Ah, também estou testando, professor, para passar pelo YouTube. Então, acredito que o pessoal está conseguindo ver pelo link. O Túlio conseguiu ajudar também. Bom dia.
Certo.
Bom dia, senhores.
Oi, Derek, bom dia.
Eu, como presidente, não avalio também, não avalio?
Avalia. Você é que escreve um relatório, por sinal.
Ah, é? Eu que mando o relatório?
Essa me manda o relatório depois da reunião secreta. Você manda o relatório, que é um parágrafo, né? E eu colo na ata e depois passo para todos. Mas você não precisa escrever online, não, viu? Depois da reunião,
Certo.
aí no depois do almoço você escreve com calma, cheque e manda.
Beleza. O Stefano, ele vai participar? Só assistir ou ele vai ver toda
Eu não sei, o Murilo deve
a
saber.
Perguntei para ele, ele falou que poderia assistir toda a parte da arguição também, mas
Certo.
ah, inclusive ele entrou. Mas
Hello, Stefano.
hello, everybody. Morning.
Hello, good morning for the Brazilian side.
Yeah, it's afternoon already over there.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Stefano, just to try and to explain. Here are the rules for the qualification exam. We are not the president of the jury. Professor Derek is going to be the president, and yourself and me, we are almost guests. They are going to argue, and in the end of the exam, the president can open the speech for both of us.
Okay. Understood.
Great. Yeah.
Okay. Just one question for the arguing phase and inquiries. Are we going to do in English or in Portuguese?
In English. I think
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, actually, the whole thing in
Stefano, it's
English.
going to take
Probably.
part, it's better in English.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, but Stefano knows Portuguese. He studied
He
by
does.
football medicine.
Well. But I think for the logistics and the way you're going to present it, it's better for us to do everything in English, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If I realize that it's just people from Brazil stay in the connection,
oh, yeah,
then
that's
we
true.
Turn
Yeah.
off the
Yeah, yeah.
video
presentation. We can switch. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, makes sense. Murilo, so just a curious question, when you're going to leave to Professor Stefano laboratory?
It's going to be the 1st of February.
Ah, okay. Oh, okay. It's soon. Okay. So
yeah,
you have one and a half month. Yeah, good. It's going to be a great experience.
Hope so.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, so I look into the preliminary results and it looks amazing. I mean, it's very good for. And I didn't check much, but I don't think there are a lot of people that know this technique here in Brazil. So, I mean, just the fact that you are going to a laboratory that have this that has this equipment, I mean, and learn
Hello,
how to do
Ricardo.
That would be great.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning, Ricardo.
Which is, we just need to wait, Carlos. I think that the other people are not going to attend.
Yeah, I think that the YouTube transmission, people are a little bit shy about being at the Google Meet room. So I think they will be watching from the live stream.
Yes, but can you check how many people are there or not?
Let me check. Let me see.
Yeah,
I
just open the window.
It's
a live stream?
Yeah, it's a live stream. There are three people watching it.
Three people. Okay.
Yes.
So far.
So far, yeah.
Well, if it is a physics department, three people is a Woodstock already.
Matheus is having the breakfast. It looks like that he's chewing something.
It's not breakfast, it's just a chewing gum. Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Good morning.
I'm in the lab now, Professor.
Okay.
But I'm in Otavio's room.
Did you have your hair cut or you took a shower this morning?
It was just a shower this morning, and then the curly hair just got down a little bit.
I hope that Carlos is not facing any problem.
Just a moment.
We have one guy from Netherlands.
I'm inviting Professor Roberto to have a World Cup finalist here. He's our
teacher. Yeah.
Let's see if he joins us.
Oh, he might be quite happy today.
Yeah. He probably is.
Let's wait for Sunday.
Today, all of us are Morocco here in Brazil, Stefan. Carlos is coming.
Okay.
Good morning, Carlos.
I think. Okay.
No, I'm sorry.
Hello, Carlos. You are muted.
Okay.
Hello.
Okay. Now, I'm just going to do the welcome. And just after, I'm going to invite Professor Derek to coordinate the meeting. Then, good morning, good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. We have today the qualification exam of Murilo. And I would like first to thank the jury for the time spent reading the text and preparing the questions. I would like to welcome firstly Dr. Carlos Pagliosa. Dr. Carlos Pagliosa is a PhD researcher of RHI Magnesita. It's the largest refractory industry in the world. And I also would like to welcome Professor Dr. Ricardo Afonso Angelico. He works at the Aeronautical Department in our other university here in São Carlos, the State University, named USP. Welcome, Ricardo. Welcome, Carlos. And our president of this jury, Professor Dr. Derek Nils Ferreira Mush, that is going to coordinate the meeting. Also, I would like to welcome the co-supervisor of this work, Professor Dr. Stefano Dalpon, that is in France, following this qualification exam, and all the members of the group that are attending via YouTube. Then I would like to call Professor Dr. Derek Nils Ferreira Mud to coordinate the meeting, and Professor Dalpon and myself, we are going to be guests, and if we have time at the end of the exam, we are going to express some thoughts about the work, or perhaps helping to Murilo to explain some of the questions. Okay, Professor Derek, thank you very much. Now it's with you.
So thank you, Professor Panofelli. Thank you, Murilo, to invite me to be part of your exam committee. So firstly, just to explain a little bit what we're going to do here. So we're going to have a presentation with about 40 minutes, right, Murilo? 40, 50 minutes.
something like that. And then we are going to start the evaluation by the committee. So for now, recently we are having some instabilities with the Wi-Fi. So in this case, I would like to just to give a heads up here. I would like to start the evaluation with Dr. Carlos Pagliosa, because he's the farthest from us here. So, and if you have any problems with Wi-Fi, we can continue the evaluation in presence. So that's the heads up I would like to talk a little bit about. Murilo, I think it's all yours now. So good luck in your presentation, good luck in your exam, and I'm looking forward to see it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Derek, and thank you, Professor Panofelli, for the introduction. And also, I would just like to foremost start by thanking everyone of the examination committee for accepting the invitation. I am really looking forward for your contributions, suggestions, and corrections to the PhD project. And also, I would like to thank Professor Stefano Dalpon for the co-supervision and Professor Panofelli for this valuable supervision. The title of the PhD project is the analysis of refractive cathodes drying via computational modeling and neutron tomography. And as you might see from all the logos, it's actually a very interdisciplinary subject in which we are very proud to have multiple connections and interactions with all these different colleagues and all these specialists. So, for introducing first the subject, we can actually see that the refractory materials can be divided in two different categories of materials. The first category is the shaped refractory materials, which are already supplied in the final shape, which is actually a benefit from the perspective of the end user. Because of that, the end user also don't need to fire them, and so in the current context of carbon dioxide emissions, this is a valuable asset to have. And also, on the other hand, these kind of materials, they rely on skilled workers for the bricklaying stages, as we can see from this animation, which is a very difficult task and demands a lot of time. And because of that as well, the maintenance is very complex and the substitution of the refractory lining requires a lot of work. And also, as you might see from the video itself, due to the thermal expansion of these bricks during the heating, we needed to account for this expansion by the use of expansion joints. And these positions, they are highly susceptible to refractory corrosion. And so this is something that can be seen as a drawback of this class of materials. On the other hand, the unshaped refractory materials, or already called as monolithics or even castables, they are a different kind of materials because in this case, the end user can apply and put this kind of materials in their final form in situ. And this enables a higher installation rate on some specific application methods. And some of those methods can even be automatized in some of the cases, leading to a very efficient substitution and repairing. Also, because of that, the expansion joints, they can be avoided on some cases, and the maintenance of this kind of lining is even easier. You can see from this animation on the far right that we are actually seeing a blast furnace in the steel production that was not completely shut down for this repair process. The challenging aspect of this kind of these materials is that some geometries, they can require anchors due to the fact that they are behaving as a fluid and in high angles. And finally, for some of the hydraulic bonded monolithic materials, the first heating is too slow, and we are going to understand why in a moment, but this slow process has several impacts. And one of the most important ones, and which motivates this work as well, is the currently scenario of global warming. So the last report of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change from 2022 showed and proved that actually it is an effect of the human activity the observed increase of the average temperature of the Earth that was observed in the last 170 years. They could prove that by the use of numerical models, which showed that the simulation when the human activity was not considered didn't show that kind of temperature increase observed by the data obtained on the last 170 years. That acts as a very important proof and something that really highlights the importance of the human nature and how we need to work in towards having better efficiency and decreasing carbon dioxide emissions and energy waste and so on. And just to give some insight and context of how brutal these drying out long curves are, we can actually compare the drying phase and the subsequent step of the heating up. The drying out is the stage in which we remove the water from these kind of hydraulic bounded materials, and the heating up is actually the process from which we go from room temperature towards the working temperature conditions. And on these comparisons, we can see that the drying out takes almost 5 days due to the existence of very small heating rates and temperature plateaus. While the heating up, you can apply faster heating rates and also you can reach the final temperature way faster. So the bottleneck of the maintenance of monolithics is the dry out for hydraulic bonded materials. And to summarize this, I also like to share this phrase from Professor Panofelli. He states that we are using the 21st century castables, which are those very complex materials that we optimize their particle size distributions, and we do know how to control their rheology aspects and all the different additives that we can use from polymeric fibers and polymeric additives and so on. But still to this date, we are applying the 19th century heat up curves, which are semi-empirical, which are not obtained or optimized through more advanced techniques. And not only the climate aspects are important, but also the monetary aspects as well, the economical losses related to this drying out. This is a quick estimative that we prepared by considering the current prices of steel, which is in a low point on this time at the moment. And we can see that 1 day of a steel ladle, which is a very important equipment for the secondary refinement of steel in the steel production line, can equal to almost $1 million of lose money. And that is a very important figure because this kind of money could be used to invest on more green initiatives that can decrease the carbon dioxide emissions and so on. And the importance of the steel industry for us as refractory engineers is pretty clear when we analyze the figures of refractory consumption per ton of product. We know that cement and steel are two of the most used and produced materials in the world. However, the difference between cement and steel on the refractory consumption is brutal. We can see that steel, with all the advances that we had in the last 30 years, steel consumes a lot of the refractories by ton of steel production in the range of 10 to 12 kilograms. And most of these refractories, they are applied to different equipment necessary for the conversion of the iron oxide to steel. And we can see from those figures as well that all these different components, they can have different shares of shaped and unshaped products. And the cases of that stood out in the use of unshaped products is the electric arc furnace and the continuous casting machine. And we see that on the case of the electric arc furnace, we have almost 70% of consumed by unshaped products, which when they are based on hydraulic bonded systems, will lead to consume of energy and carbon dioxide emissions and so on due to the drying stage. This trend, there is also a trend that will also make in our perspective, it will create a condition in which the drying will become even a further complex scenario. If we take a look on the steel industry, they are moving from the carbon monoxide based reduction of the iron oxide towards the green hydrogen used to make this process less carbon dioxide emitting. And to do so, they will need to change the production pipelines, and so now the blast furnace equipment will be substituted by the electric furnace itself, and so we can expect that the consumption of unshaped products will be even further and will be a more important issue as well for this industrial aspect. And also another aspect of the hydrogen move, especially when talking about alternative fuels, is presented by James Herrick comment on the bulletin of the American Ceramic Society, in which he mentions that the transition from natural gas to hydrogen can lead to an accelerated wear, chemical attack, and overheating of the refractory, probably reducing the service life and increasing the maintenance times that are done by each cycle. And so optimized drying is a latent issue. But now let's try to understand why these heating schedules are used and why they're so long. And we can observe this laboratory test of Portland cement concrete in this cube that is on the top of this hot plate. What we see is a phenomenon named as explosive spalling, which is the successive removal of pieces of the of this material due to the pressurization and thermal stresses that occur inside this material. This is not something that we only see for Portland cement concrete. The launching pad of these rockets can also be prone to this kind of issue. This is a short clip from the latest test of the Starship from SpaceX motor, and it shows that several debris were actually thrusted to the air. And don't get it wrong from the scales, because these are actually very large pieces of this launching pad that were propelled due to the explosive spalling itself. We also can observe that on the industrial practice, and we can observe this on several instances of refractory lining fading due to these kind of pressurization mechanisms. And so we need to understand a little bit better. And now I would like to present our overview of our laboratory group drying project, and also how this is connected to the specific objectives of our PhD project. So everything turns around and revolves on the explosive spalling. And we do believe that by understanding this explosive spalling, we have the key to unlock reliable numerical simulations that can be further used to heat up curves optimization. And that is a line of development that is already being done in parallel by the PhD student Tulio Mumik Cunha, which applies some of the models that we are working right now to improve in order to study the effects of changing those heating rates, the plateau temperatures, and so on. But the explosive spalling, as already mentioned, is a combination of the pressurization of the water vapor in specifically a phenomenon known as moisture clog, and also the combination of that moisture clog with thermomechanical stresses. So we can divide those points and lines of development of the drying project, as we can see here. So for the high temperature permeometer is an equipment that was developed here in our laboratory, in which we can see the effect of the heating on the transformations of the microstructure that lead to different values of permeability with evolution of the temperature. We are also actively studying permeability enhancing additives to try to make this process safer. And also now with the collaboration of Professor Stefano Dalpon, we are trying to observe the drying in situ. In the thermomechanical stresses front, we are trying to develop a phase field crack propagation model, which can lead to the understanding of the contributions of the pressurization and also the thermomechanical stresses to the cracking. For the scale effect, we do believe that this topic is very important, because all the observations that we have in the laboratory scale is limited to small samples. And when we consider that these refractory structures are on the orders of magnitude larger and bigger, we can expect that there is in fact a scale effect. And finally, we are trying to understand as well the microwave drying with the collaboration of our colleagues from our department in order to decrease these thermomechanical stresses through volumetric heating. With all these aspects, we are also collaborating with specialists, so Professor Murilo Innocentini, which was the researcher that developed this equipment, and in our PhD study, we tried to obtain data to complement the neutron tomography tests. We also want to apply both of the high temperature permeometer and in situ observations to better understand the behavior of polymeric fibers, which is the main kind of permeability enhancing additives used in the industry. And if we do understand these mechanisms of permeability increase, we can then provide Professor Caio Ottoni, which is a specialist on polymer engineering, and then he can try to optimize the properties of those additives to make them work better and be more efficient. For the in-situ observations, we have the collaboration of my co-supervisor, Professor Stefano Dalpon, in which we want to visualize the drawing and obtain the required properties for our numerical models, which we are developing with the valuable help of Professor Roberto Alzas, and which we want to analyze the cracking and the stresses on different scenarios. For the scale effect, we are counting with the help of Elkin, which is a raw material producing for the refractory industry, in the person of Hong Peng. And we want to understand and try to uncover the scaling laws and the volume effect on the drawing. And for the micro drawing, we can count with the help of Professor Rodolfo Bunwick and then the analysis of the potential of volumetric heating for the drawing, both numerically and experimentally. And here we are counting with the help of the undergraduate Fernando Schmidt. With that said, we can now focus a little bit more on the fundamental basis of this PhD project. And as we mentioned, the explosive spalling is the main subject that we needed to understand. And it is actually a combination of the heat transfer, the mass transfer, the mechanical behavior. And it always starts with the heat transfer, because in the industrial scenario, the drying is controlled by the application of a temperature heated curve. And it is actually the energy input to the system and also the control variable. It promotes the phase change and the pressure gradients that will lead to the mass transport, which will dictate the balance between the water vapor generation through evaporation and dehydration, and also the how fast we can remove those water molecules from within the porosity of the material. And if we're not fast enough, pressurization can occur, leading to stresses. And so we can understand the mechanical behavior, which will reflect the process conditions. And in a way, it's the process variable that we are trying to indirectly control. The connection of the mass transport and mechanical behavior is pretty clear. The pressurization itself will lead to stresses. And all these stresses can lead to damage. And this damage will affect the properties of the material. So for instance, the intrinsic permeability represented by kappa here is a function of the temperature, the saturation degree, and the damage, as well as the Young modulus and all the different properties as well. The thermomechanical stresses is the link between the heat transfer and the mechanical behavior. And often this aspect is neglected, and it's something very important to consider. And finally, the heat transfer is directly linked to the mass transport itself due to the phase changes and the convection itself that occurs, and also the effect of the temperature on the properties of the materials. Under very specific conditions, all of these mechanisms can lead to the explosive spalling. But now I think it's a moment for us to understand a little more about the material that we are studying. And as I mentioned earlier, we are talking about a hydraulic bonded material, which is based on calcium aluminate cement. This class of hydraulic bonded materials, they develop their green strength through hydratation reactions that occur. In the case of calcium aluminate cement, these crystalline phases are a byproduct of the dissolution nucleation mechanisms that we can see summarized on this scheme, in which these very complex reactions occur, leading to the dissolution of cations that will further precipitate on crystalline phases, leading to a microstructure which comprises the aggregates, the matrix and secondary raw materials, and the pores themselves. And those pores are very important because it is within them that we have the pressurization that we want to control. Also, we needed to account that the water itself in our material can assume different configuration. We can actually have the unreacted capillary absorbed water on the surfaces of the aggregates and in the frontiers of the matrix. This water did not take participation to the hydratation mechanisms of the calcium aluminate cement binder, so they are residual water that we needed to remove. But we also have water from the hydrates themselves, which will dehydrate at specific temperatures in a thermally activated process. And also we need to account for the water vapor itself, and we needed to consider that all of these phases will be changing during the drying phenomenon. And so this subject can be seen as the study of a partially saturated porous medium, which have several frameworks to study and to understand those concepts. And it all dates back to the studies of Henri Darcy from 1850s, in which he was the first researcher to actively try to understand the effect of the flow on porous medium. And he proposed and devised the first permeameter to study the water flow through sand banks. The sand itself is a consolidated aggregate of small grains of sand, in which creates a very open porosity situation from which the water can percolate those pores. We are going to apply the same ideas, but here we need to be careful because actually our kind of material, either Portland cement concrete or even the refractory castables that we are studying, have a greater content of closed pores. And water moves on these closed pores through very complex relationships and paths that lead to very complex phase transformations. So for instance, a water vapor molecule here would need to actually absorb on this free adsorption layer or diffuse through the capillary water and then move by different potential thermodynamical quantities that leads to this movement of water from the closed pores. But with that said, we can now shift our attention to the explosive spalling itself, which is related to the moisture clock that I already mentioned. And here we are going to try to just understand from this simplified schematics. Let's assume that we have a refractory castable that is being heated from this left surface. This heating will lead to thermal and pressure gradients inside of it. And this pressurization gradient will lead to a Darcy flow. And this Darcy flow will be both on the direction of the hot surface and the cold surface. However, on the cold surface, due to the smaller temperatures, water will start to condensate and saturate the pores themselves, creating more challenges and difficulties for water to move towards the cold surface. In the limit of this process, all the pores are saturated, and so we cannot have more water coming out from the surface, leading to a quick pressurization event that will create a tensile stress state that can open cracks in our material. But we can remember from the video that actually it's not a cracking issue. It's more like an explosion effect. And from where this energy comes out is something that was an open question, but now it is kind of assumed that actually the explosive spalling itself is a superposition of two mechanisms. So we do have the moisture clog effect, which will create the tensile states, and we will act as the trigger for this energy release. But the bulk of this energy, this potential energy, comes from thermomechanical stresses related to the uneven heating of this hot surface. And this uneven heating, that it creates a compressive state that creates a lot of strain energy that is suddenly released when we have the explosive spalling event. From then on, we now can focus more on some selected fronts of those that we presented and show the methods and preliminary results to each one of them. We will start with the neutron imaging, and by that we can compare with different techniques. So let's take, for instance, the neutron tomography technique. It's a very complex technique that has the advantages of having a great contrast between the regions that have water and regions that are dry. And also, we can have a 3D result. Also, another point is that the neutron will interact differently with the matrix and with the aggregates due to the different contents of water. And so we can actually segmentate the aggregates and focus our attention in the matrix itself. The disadvantages is that this technique is limited to small samples, especially when we need to consider the thickness, or in this case, the diameter of the cylindric sample. Also, we are not capable of having a distinction between the capillary and adsorbed water, and it's a very complex and expensive technique because it relies on a nuclear reactor to provide the neutron beam in order to have neutron imaging images. On the other hand, a cheaper technique is the X-ray tomography, because we can rely on X-ray tube, which is a simpler beam source. We can have that on a desk. It's a very smaller equipment, and also it will result on 3D-dimensional results as well. But it will have the same disadvantages of the neutron tomography, and also it will have a bad contrast. So we cannot have a segmentation of the aggregates. And even worse, to recover the water distribution, we needed to rely on very complex mathematical treatment of the data, which can lead to numerical artifacts and reduces the reproducibility and the feasibility of this technique. We also have the nuclear magnetic resonance, which is an alternative method which relies on the relaxation time of the water molecules. And because of that, this relaxation time can distinguish between the capillary and the adsorbed water due to the effect of the surface interaction with those molecules, changing this relaxation time. And also, we can directly focus on the free water molecules. So we can actually see the changes of water configuration as we are not detecting the hydrates themselves, which is the case for neutron tomography. The disadvantage, though, is that this technique is limited, again, to small samples. And also, it is a one-dimensional result. We cannot reconstruct the three-dimensional of the sample and the distribution of water content and so on. And another aspect is that most of the studies are done at room temperature, even though recently there were some researchers that sacrificed a bit on the resolution in order to obtain a high temperature result. But still, it's a technique that is not as direct as the neutron or X-ray tomography. Another aspect important for the X-ray tomography, I forgot to mention, is that we can actually see pretty well the pores and also the cracks in the material. But now our methods that we were already capable of performing some tests through our collaboration with Professor Stefano Dalpon and Alessandro Tengatini from the Institute Laue-Langevin. The idea is that we are making those tomography analysis from several projections that we can reconstruct by the back propagation algorithm and back projection that lead to the reconstruction of the topology and geometry of our sample. And in the case of the next equipment, which is the name of the neutron tomography equipment at the Institute Laue-Langevin, we can actually perform simultaneously the neutron and X-ray tomographies. And that is very important because those different beams will interact different with the material. For instance, the neutrons will preferably interact with the nuclei from the atoms, while the X-rays will interact with the electrons themselves. This leads to different absorptions. And most important, for the hydrogen itself, it has a great absorption of neutrons. And so the hydrogen that is present on the water molecules and on the hydrates will create a good contrast with the regions that do not have this hydrogen as well. Then we have a very good technique to observe the drying. However, it comes with a very steep price because we are using the nuclear reactor facility, and this is a very competitive because a lot of researchers want to apply this technique to different cases, and so it's not that easy or available. Even though we already made some preliminary tests that were very interesting and showed and highlighted the potential of the technique, based on the setup in which the sample is cast inside an alumina casing. We also put this sample inside a cylindrical environment with rock wool in order to have a thermal insulation, and all of this setup is on the top of a turntable. The casing, we actually tested also mullite casings, but we saw that the alumina casing was already a good alternative. We're going to see why in a moment. And our material that we are analyzing is a hydraulic bonded high alumina composition based on 5% of calcium aluminate cement and 4.5% of water. The case here for the use of the alumina casing is twofold. The first aspect is that by using this alumina casing, we can enforce a one-dimensional drying. And these boundary conditions will enable us to reproduce the scenario of the application. So, for instance, the drying of a refractory lining. And that can be done in a way that it surpasses some of these limitations of the neutron tomography, because even though we are limited by the sample thickness, we can still have taller samples within some margins for sure, but we can play a little bit around with this thickness of, or actually height of the cylinder, which is equal to the thickness of the flat wall application that we are trying to study. Not only that, but the second aspect of why we are favoring one-dimensional drawing is related to the fact that we want to avoid one very specific artifact that occurs when we are putting neutron beams passing through our material, which is the beam hardening effect. To explain that a little better, we needed to consider that this neutron beam is actually made of a distribution of neutrons with different values of energy. These different neutrons will interact different with our solid material, and the ones that have a small content of energy will actually be drifted more, and so our sample will act as a filter and remove some of those low energy neutrons. And these will actually create a false or a not real distribution of intensities. If we take, for instance, a radial cut, as we can see, there are some regions on the borders that will have a smaller intensity of neutron absorption than the regions in the bulk. And even for an homogeneous material, which we would not see any kind of heterogeneity without the beam hardening effect. And this is especially difficult for us because if we're not using the casing, water can escape on the radial direction. And then we cannot separate what is the effect of water removal and what is the beam hardening effect. And so we cannot quantitatively analyze the water accumulation and other quantities of interest in our sample. To solve that, we needed to use a ceramic casing that actually had a similar thermal expansion than our sample. And this is why aluminum worked so well for our own case. Now, going for the results, the segmentation of the castable showed it to us really well that we had some pores and also the aggregates, and we could shift our attention to what happened with the matrix itself and how water could percolate around those aggregates, especially because in our case, tabular alumina has non-porosity and actually no permeability. And so water will actually need to percolate through this medium. We now also could analyze those data, not only on the three-dimensional representation as is seen on the far left, but also as a histogram of the intensity of the neutrons detected. And this is an interesting and clever idea because it enables us to actually see the segmentation values for the intensity of each one of these different phases that we have on this heterogeneous structure of the refractory castable. For instance, we could see in the initial moments at this dark blue curve that we had a wet matrix intensity around 40,000 arbitrary units. The dry matrix intensity frequency actually increased when we arrived in the end of this test of the drying, because all of the concrete was dried, and then we could see more neutrons with that same kind of intensity at that peak. And this was important because it helped us to have quantitative analysis. But not only that, we could also analyze this data by qualitative analysis, by considering what happened on axial cuts and radial cuts of the sample. And this kind of observation could actually lead to the understanding of three different regions of this material. For instance, we can see the drying region on the back of the drying front. And between the drying front and the initial status condition, we observed a moisture accumulation that was directly linked with the moisture clog mechanisms. So we could prove that actually, even in very small samples, we can observe moisture clog, as we can see here. For sure, on the sample without the ceramic casing, we could not conclude any quantitative analysis due to the effect of the beam hardening. But what we saw was that on the back of this curved drying front, water accumulated. In the case of the sample with the casing on, we could see flat drying fronts and also could calculate and understand that any accumulation on these positions is a physical value, and so it's related to the moisture clogging that is occurring on larger samples. But not only that, another observation was that there was a secondary drying front from the bottom of the sample, which was not expected and which could be linked to the drying that occurs due to the moisture flux towards the cold surface of the unidimensional drying sample. We also devised an gradient-based algorithm in order to detect the drying fronts of each one of these compositions to observe and compare the effect of the ceramic casing. And by using these algorithms, we could actually compare these values and guarantee that we are not having boundary effects related to the beam hardening artifact. We also used the three-dimensional representation to observe how the water could percolate through these aggregates and escape from it. For sure, by the limitation of the resolution that we applied, we could not see directly the water in the pores and how that movement occurred, but we could still have an overall and qualitative analysis of this drying phenomenon. Another case of study that we were capable of doing was the study of the effect of different heating protocols of these samples. As we know from practice that this is a very important quantity. And we saw that for the fast heated sample, drying already started to take place after 15 minutes. At 39 minutes, we already seen that almost 1/4 of the sample was completely dried, while only now the slow heating sample started to be dried. But one very interesting and unexpected result was that in the end, both of the cases had a very similar water moisture accumulation and water distribution. And this is probably related to the fact that what we are seeing here is indeed a transition from a heating dominated zone of the drying and a limited limited zone by the thermal conduction of the sample itself. The next steps for this neutron imaging front is to actually use numerical models to benchmark the permeability and sorption isotherms properties of the refractory casticles, because we do know that these properties are very important to actually be able to model this drying, and also because there are lots of doubts on the techniques that are commonly used to obtain both the permeability and the sorption isotherms. We are also going to have an internship at the University of Grenoble Alps under the guidance of Professor Stefan Dalpon to propose new neutron tomography tests in compositions containing polymeric fibers. We hope to understand a little bit better how they enhance the permeability of the material through their decomposition and so on. With that said, we can now move to the second group of methods and preliminary results, which is the thermal hydromechanical phase field model. And we are going to start by presenting a simplified view of this model. And again, as we already mentioned, it all starts with the heating and the simulation of the temperature distribution inside the sample. This heating will lead to a pressurization. And this is exactly what we are capable of obtaining by a thermal hydro model, which was the models that we developed during my master thesis using an open source tool named Phoenix, based on Python programming language. And the idea of these models was that we could obtain pressurization values and compare them with different conditions. However, what we aim to do now is to understand the effect of this pressurization on the stresses that the samples are feeling due to this heating. And also, we needed to always remember that the heating itself can lead to thermomechanical stresses due to the thermal expansion. And we do know that the stresses can be related with the strain through constitutive equations in relating to the Hooke's law. And also, by assuming equilibrium conditions, we can solve the displacement of these different points inside our material and recovering the strains and the stresses in this material by assuming a linear elastic behavior. But what we aim to do as well is not only consider these mechanical aspects, but also we want to understand the cracking and the fracture process that occurs. And to do so, we are going to link these strain and stresses with the changes in the potential energy of our body. And this agrees and follows the approach of Griffith's theory of fracture, which has an energy balance of the cracking phenomenon. And with a crack model, we can actually simulate the crack behavior and understand in which conditions we start to see cracks and when they start to grow. The hybrid phase field model approach that we are going to use is based on the equilibrium conditions equations in which we account for the effect of the damage through the phase field variable, which will say to us if the material is cracked or not at a given position. And we are going to solve them as a function of the displacements, which will be the primary variable related to the equilibrium equation. And for the energy balance equation in the bottom here, we are going to account for the strain energy in the material and also to the energy of the surfaces of the crack through a quantity that is named the crack surface density, which is a function of the phase field variable itself and a semi-empirical quantity named as the size scale, the characteristic length of the crack. With all this information, we can now couple these kinds of analysis with the thermohygrom model, leading to a thermohygromechanical phase field model. But before doing so, we wanted to benchmark our implementation of the phase field model by only considering the stresses and strain of very simplified problems. And we started with this case of this square, two-dimensional square, under tensile stress. And following the proposals and analysis of Professor Ricardo of always benchmarking numerical results with solutions that are based on analytical equations, we could actually test both quadrilateral and triangular elements and compare those results with the analytical solution, showing that we could actually match pretty well the actual stresses and the phase field variable at different axial strains. One point, however, is that this is a very simple stress condition. What we also wanted was to benchmark this test by considering a more complex scenario of a three-bending case with a notch. And we did that by comparing our work, which is based on the hybrid phase field model, with an anisotropic model from the literature. And we could see that, generally speaking, the behavior of the force and displacement curves were pretty similar, but the differences that we see here match exactly the differences that were described in the literature from using a hybrid model instead of an anisotropic model. Just a quick comment here, this anisotropic model is not related to the anisotropy concept of material science, but it's rather related to how we are going to account for the behavior of the cracks by considering specific mathematical conditions on how to uncouple and to separate the contributions of tensile, compressive strain, stress, and so on. But also we could see that both of the models agreed in the left here, the anisotropic model, and on the right, the hybrid model, they agreed with the velocity of the crack in front. And our model also converged to the analytical value of the dissipated energy by this crack with this given length. And when we consider finer meshes and slower applications of the displacement. With that said, our next steps for this development front is to couple the thermohygrom problem to the phase field model, which was an innovative proposal and approach in the beginning of the PhD project. But in the beginning of this year, Cheng and colleagues started to publish some works doing exactly the same idea, but on the context of spalling of Portland cement concrete. And we want to actually use his results to benchmark our implementation. And we are also trying to benchmark the model with experimental results from the literature as well to actually have a validation of the model. But we are also looking forward to improve these models by proposing a substepping algorithm for the staggered solver and implement an adaptive substepping algorithm that can calculate this pseudo time step automatically. Now, to end this presentation, we are going to present our results from the scale effect analysis. And we are going to use the thermogravimetry tests to do this analysis and this study. And we are going to do so because thermogravimetry is a very straightforward test in which we can measure the mass of the sample with a scale during a heating process. And we are going to do so by using a small cylindrical sample, which is the one that we conventionally use it here in our lab, which is a cylinder with 50 millimeters in height and 50 millimeters in diameter, as we can see here in this image, and which has a mass of around 250 grams. However, but we are going to do so with the heating rates of 2, 5, and 10 degrees Celsius per minute. But with our collaboration of our colleagues of Elking, they are devising an equipment that can take some tests on samples with 80 kilograms, which are actually 30 centimeter size cubes. And due to this high volume of concrete and the dangerous explosive spalling case for such a high scale samples, they are limited to a smaller heating rate of 0.66 degrees Celsius per minute. We need to account that they have different heating conditions due to the placing of the radiant heater, but we could still compare the differences between the furnace temperature and the sample temperature, which is an indirect measurement of the thermal gradient inside the sample with the temperature on the surface. And we can see that the samples that were heated with the lowest heating rates of 2 and 5 degrees Celsius were the ones with the smallest heating rate. However, as we increased that heating rate to 20 degrees Celsius per minute, the sample did not have enough time to heat with the same pace as the furnace did, leading to this large thermal gradient. However, one interesting feature was that the macro TGA sample was the one with the smallest heating rate, but still in the initial 250 degrees Celsius of the furnace temperature, it was the one with one of the largest thermal gradients, due to the large thermal inertia of such a high volume specimen. We also observed in the macro TGA some very specific characteristics that were not uncovered by the smaller conventional TGA tests, such as this kind of point here around 300 degrees Celsius, this kink on the curve. We reproduced these large scale tests several times and observed this kink every time. And we are trying to study and understand better why of that. Considering the mass loss, we can separate the drying at three main stages. The first one is the evaporation, the second one is the ebullition, and the third phase is the hydration. And the interesting aspect is that the first two stages of evaporation and ebullition match pretty well the macro TGA behavior with the conventional TGA one, due to a compensation of the smaller volume of the conventional TGA by applying a faster heating rate. And that is a very interesting aspect because it can lead to an approach on how to reproduce the conditions of structural elements with smaller samples. When considering these two stages of the drying, because the dehydration, as we already mentioned, it is a thermally activated process, and so it's highly prone to the heating rate. And so we could see a large difference on this part, but not that big for the 2 and 5 degrees Celsius per minute heating. Those changes were already observed on the derivatives of the mass loss with respect to the temperature themselves by the water removal peaks that were identified. And the next step for this part is to analyze intermediary size, to check the scale effect on polymeric fibers containing compositions, and to use numerical models to complement the experimental results and better understand the effect of pressurization and temperature distributions inside the sample. So, to finish this presentation, the current developments on this PhD project is we are starting a collaboration with the National Laboratory of Synchrotron Light, the Sirius at Campinas, with the Mogno team to prepare an in-situ drying equipment really similar to the one that is already present at the Institute Lauer Langevin. We expect that the higher intensity of the X-rays from the Sirius light will make it for us able to analyze this drying as well. We are developing an Arduino-based data acquisition system for the high temperature permeameter to improve and actually put it to work again after some time with no use. And in the microwave TGA development, we are trying to obtain the mass loss curves from the microwave volumetric heating, and we're trying to optimize this equipment because it's still in a preliminary stage. And finally, we are trying to understand the theoretical effect of the thermal expansion of the polymeric fibers which some authors explain and defend that is the reason of the permeability increase observed by the use of these additives. Regarding the schedule of the PhD project, we are right in the middle of it. We already finished the courses required for it. The bibliographic review we're going to do all the time, and the computational models development is right in the middle as well, finishing the first sets of benchmarks. And we were capable of participating in conferences and writing research papers. For the next semester, we are going to have the internship at the Université Grenoble Alpes, and also to perform the neutron X-ray tomography test. And we want to have the post-treatment of that data as well. And the thesis defense is programmed for the end of 2024. We already have two published reviewed papers at the Journal of the American Ceramic Society presenting our results of the neutron tomography of the drying. And we were able of participating in three different conferences presenting proceedings in the NITESR 2022 at Chicago, in the International Colloquium of Refractories at Aachen, and on the LFR 2022 at Foz do Iguaçu. With that said, I would like to thank you all very much and take a quick moment to just thank all my colleagues at our laboratory group, GEM, and also to our colleagues and the secretaries from the graduate school, our valuable help from Professor Roberto Federico Alzas, the collaboration with the University of Grenoble Alpes and the Institute Lauelangevin with Professor Stefan Dalpon and Alessandro Tengatini, the collaboration with the Elkin team, and also the valuable discussions and ideas from the REGI Magnesita team, and also all the support of the FIRE group in the person of Chris Parr and Sido Cinema, which were key for my professional formation. Thank you all very much.
Okay, Murilo, thank you very much for your, thank you very much for your presentation. So now we are going to proceed to the agreement, so the questions from the exam committee. But before, just to I remember you commented with me that someone would like to give some words before the start. We start the exam. What do you think, Professor Stefano? Would like to give us some words, or it can be by the end of the exam?
I think that would be better, Derek, at the end of the questions.
Perfect. Okay, that's all right. So let's start. So I would like to invite Dr. Carlos, as he is the furthest one from us, and if we have some, we have experienced some instability with the Wi-Fi. So if we have some problem with the Wi-Fi, at least we got one of the committee done. So, Dr. Carlos, please, this is all yours now, so you can start.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Thanks for the invitation, Murilo and all the team. I was wondering, when I started reading this, your qualification, if you really have friends or not, because if you do not have friends, this is exactly a topic to be approached for a kind of a qualification. But in the other hand, if you really have friends, this is also the exact topic to be approached because of the complexity, and also because this was a hard work. Then, first of all, I'd like to congratulate you for the election of this topic, because this is really a real one based on a real necessity that we have from the industry. And also, this is a very a good topic to associate the science and also the needs that we have for the application. As mentioned in the earlier, this is not a new one related to the what we face during the refractory history, but this one is still lacking a lot of information and understanding. And then I also, I'm very satisfied that we could add some new techniques to explore this so complex topic. And also very happy that we can use new tools to search for this new understanding and afterwards construct the solution. Then, okay, this I think you really accepted the challenges for this one, and I have for sure some comments about that. But before starting my questions, I would like just to congratulate you for the advanced material that you sent. This is a kind of a correct risk for the candidate that I see is really appreciated, because not just because you send it in advance, and also it facilitates the work from our side, but also because it shows how the worry that you have for your work. It is like this kind of details that it's very important when we are facing this complex study, because we have to look in a very systemic approach. And preparing this one in advance looks like that you also dedicated a lot of time to have this manuscript ready. And by the reading, I saw that just very few, it's really very few suggestions or corrections. Most of them is just related to the technical terms that we use in the refractory industry that could be changed, but the whole idea is very well written. Also congratulated about this dedication for writing this manuscript that I think it corresponds to the not just the way that you send in advance, but also how much time you dedicated for putting all this information together in a very clear way. I have just regarding to this one, I have some questions. Is that first, why you decided to use the neutron? I saw that you have this. You justify how you for the different techniques. Why you choose the neutron tomography, and then you are so confident that we could have so valuable information from that? What is the main reason that you choose this one? And after this question, I would like how is the way that you pretend to connect both techniques, this computational modeling with this neutron tomography?
Okay, so thank you very much, Dr. Carlos, for the comments. To answer you, I think I have some friends, but I'm thinking that after this PhD, I'm making more of them, especially by the people that are helping so much. And that is something that is one of the great parts of participating on this project. Regarding the neutron tomography use itself, I think it's a combination of luck and friends, as you mentioned. Everything started by the master analysis, in which we studied a lot of different numerical models for the drying. And during these studies, I came up to the conclusion, one of the conclusions of the master study was that actually the study of the drying of refractory castables is not as intense, or there are not so much people doing such kind of studies as there is people in the civil engineering department. The civil engineers have a very similar problem in the fire accidents, But the only difference is that their heating rates are very larger than ours, and they are not controlled. They are an accident. They are not a process. But we tried to just catch up with the people from the civil engineering, try to understand their work. They had more complex models and so on. And in doing so, we came in contact with the work of Professor Stefano Dal Pont. And one day we had an exchange of messages in ResearchGate, and I was having some trouble trying to implement the complex models, thermal hygrometry models from the people of civil engineering. And in 2020, Professor Stefano started to help a lot with the implementation of the models, but also an understanding the different natures of the tomography and imaging techniques that were starting to be applied in Portland cement concrete. So basically we were already very confident that these techniques would be valuable to us, as they were already valuable for the Portland cement concrete community. Then we decided to send some test samples to Professor Stefano, which is this first pack of results, package of results that I presented in this qualification. And that showed a very good potential. And we started to see, and actually it's a very complex task, because we are talking about in the range of 20 to 50 gigabytes of data. And so the analyzing of these and post-processing was a very long task. But at the same time, we started to see that more than showing the potential of the tool, we were already capable of obtaining some conclusions. And then from those conclusions, we saw, okay, it's a very valid set of results, and this is why we worked on the papers and so on. But at the same time, we tried to compare with the work of others that were using nuclear magnetic resonance and also the X-ray tomography. And we saw that there was a lot of limitations to those techniques, and that Newton tomography itself as well has some limitations. But I would say that the largest one is the feasibility of doing those kind of tests, because the competition is so high. We are talking about having proposals that are disputing with other 650 others proposals. So that is complex to have some time at the institute to have this kind of analysis. And so we want to try to complement that with our collaboration with the Sirius team, so at Campinas. And so we believe that Newton tomography is a very valuable idea and analysis, but as Professor Panofelli always says, and I agree with you, it would be amazing to have a Newton tomography equipment on our lab. But as we can do so, we are trying to be a little closer. Perhaps at Campinas, it's a little closer than France, and we will be able to have these kind of techniques. The challenge is that they are still commissioning the X-ray tomography equipment there. They already have a lot of experience on the nano scale and the micro scale, but for the centimeters scale of the samples that we are using, it will take more time. And but I think usually that this is it. I don't know if I, I talk too much and not answer your question or not.
What takes me attention is that the computational modeling is a kind of technique that is a prediction. Mm-hmm. And the neutron tomography is like a visible technique. Then I face interesting because you are adding two techniques, that one is okay, you have to collect the data, that's experimental one, but it's most like a mathematical model. But even like this one, we could have very nice results from this technique. This kind of seeing what's really happened is also interesting, this connection between a prediction and also a visible effect. That's what I point out, like as a very, very nice complementation between both techniques. Regarding to this drying effect, most of them was studied based on the heating the samples, this normal heating that you have from outside to inside. And I saw that one of your challenges to the PhD is using the microwave. Did you think that this kind of model could also be changed when we apply this kind of new heating method?
Yes. Actually, well, who knows? Maybe in a post-PhD, postdoc, I don't know, perhaps we would be able to put them together. My dream at 2020 was to actually make the microwave drying in the Newton tomography equipment and compare the effect of that directional drying and the volumetric drying. However, at that moment, we were not specialists, and we are not specialists on microwaves, and even the Newton tomography tests were so new for us. So what we want to first do is to work a little bit on parallel. So as I am working, preparing my internship, I also tried to study a little bit more on the microwave and create some connections with the people from our department that are specialists on the microwave to understand a little bit better the intricacies and the specificities of this kind of volumetric heating. And we already had a microwave equipment here, and this is why we tried to have that TGA test. I would just put here the hided slides here. I had some of the microwaves ones. And this is the setup that we proposed. So basically, it's the same as a thermogravimetry equipment, but inside a microwave cavity. And we do believe that from it, we can start to analyze the effect and compare microwave, conventional microwave, and the traditional TGA. But most importantly, what we want to do is to validate numerical models of these microwave drying, to actually then come together with better properties that were obtained by the Newton tomography. I think that on the first comment that you made, I was forgetting to mention that the models, they are only as good as the properties that we input to those models. And the most important challenge is that modeling drying is complex because it's such a high dynamic situation in which everything is changing. The microstructure is changing, the phases are changing, the thermoconductivity, the permeability, the density, all of these properties, porosity, they are all changing during the drying. And to measure that by traditional techniques is such a difficulty that we do not believe that we can only assume that the properties that we have are the right ones and model them together. We want to be sure that we are having the great properties that describe not only the condition and the property at a given moment, but throughout all the drying. And this is why we are using together the computational methods and the Newton tomography. And the idea is that with the good properties obtained by the Newton tomography, we can then have a numerical model of the microwave drying. And then at least we could put all of them together in the framework of the phase field model and see if we are less prone to crack through the use of a volumetric heating, because we are almost removing the thermomechanical stresses that are generated by the localized superficial heating of the conventional drying methods. And so this is the end goal of the PhD project. But at the same time, we have limited resources, we have limited time, and we wouldn't like to compromise with FAPESP to say, oh, we're going to have microwave modeling in the PhD project and so on. And this is why we are dividing it with the undergrad researcher, Fernando Schmidt, and he is performing very well on these aspects. And we hope to join them together, join the works with Tulio as well, and optimize the drying curves based on the cracking and so on. But these are plans for the future.
Okay. But just regarding about the microstructure complexity, because you mentioned that for sure the microstructure changes during the drying. But also, if you cast one sample to another and the second one, also we could have this microstructure changing. And did you have any strategy how to approach this difference in the microstructure changing during the preparation of the samples?
Yes, that's a great point. It's not that easy, especially because another challenge is not only the statistical difference that we have from different samples, but also because we are preparing the samples here in São Carlos and we are going to analyze them in France. So we can guarantee that they will have the same processing route here, but then when they are transporting, they will be subject to different temperatures, different conditions, and we are not completely sure if we are having a systematic effect. Another complexity is that we are not capable of performing 5 or maybe 6 replicate tests on the neutron tomography because we are limited to the time of it. So what we try to do is to actually favor at least 1 or 2 replicates of the neutron tomography tests, because we do believe that it's important to have this statistical effect at least calibrated. But most importantly, we are also trying to always normalize the values by the initial state. So at least we see the evolution with respect to the original condition of the sample, regardless of what happened before the beginning of the drying case. But I agree with you, these drawings, they can have different behaviors, they will have different porosity distribution and so on. But then again, this is the great point of this technique. We can have a great detail of the initial condition. We can see the aggregate size distribution, we can compare the porosity distribution and so on. And with the preliminary results, I tried to do this kind of analysis. We didn't investigate a lot or further on these replication aspects, but we were capable of having 5 samples that were drying, and 3 of them were with the same heating procedure. And with these 3 compositions, I could compare their behavior and at least the distribution of aggregates and their particle size distribution curves for individual samples were pretty similar to the ones that we designed. So I know that this will not completely solve this issue, but it is something that we can try to do and we aim to do in order to tackle this. But we needed to be always careful and understand that each microstructure will be individual. It's difficult to say, oh, okay, every sample has the same particle size distribution, the aggregate sizes and pores and so on.
But this is the real variability that we have in practice. We don't have, even in the bricks, that it's more controlled, the same microstructure. And I think this natural complexity that we have from casting the material, it will be also valuable. Another point is that I saw that you add these polymeric fibers also. This is an extra complexity also. And this one also can be evaluated by the neutron tomography. There's no interference on these measurements.
Yes, but at one point, there is the resolution of the neutron tomography technique. For instance, we are not going to be capable of observing the polymer fibers individually and even the microcracks that might occur due to those limitations, because it's always a balance. If we want to have a higher spatial resolution, we sacrifice the temporal resolution, and then it takes longer to obtain the projections and to actually see these microstructure features. Again, we are planning on using these kind of tests in which we have a very fine resolution in the beginning of test, which takes long, and then we move to a faster beaming of the results to have a smaller spatial resolution, but at least perform faster tomographies. And in the end, we are going to have another high resolution tomography as well. We believe that this strategy would solve some of these issues. But as you mentioned, from what we see in the literature, we are going to see more interfaces and differences from the castable to the polymer in the X-ray tomography, because the neutron tomography will detect the hydrogen. So the hydrogen of the polymeric fibers themselves could be mistakenly considered to be the moisture itself. So it's not an easy distinction. But the density changes and differences between the polymer and the castable is large. And we know that there is a relationship between density of the phases and the intensity of the X-ray absorption. So we believe that with the X-ray, we will be capable of at least having a better understanding of what happens, especially from some works of some students of Professor Stefano Dalpon that were analyzing cracking on the material by X-ray tomography. The point that you mentioned about the variability, I completely agree that it is something that in the real case we need to account for. But at the moment, we do believe that besides the characterization of the tech of the sample, which is highly subject to the variability, we are also trying to use this in situ observation for better understanding of the drying process. So more generally speaking, how a partially saturated media behaves during the drying, during the heating, and the effects of different heating rates and so on. And these more general conclusions are less subject to this variability. At least it's something that we do believe, and it aids to complement the understanding of the drying. For sure, for the characterization, variability will always be our Achilles heel, but for the moment, it is something that we can contribute to the community.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned that this technique was used also for the civil concrete. And in civil concrete, they use large aggregates that usually we do in the refractory castable. But it was capable to use the same tomography for measuring with the biggest aggregate, or they have to adapt to use this equipment?
Yes. Actually, they needed to adapt. That was a good point. And another limitation, when I mentioned it about the size limitation of the samples, I forgot to mention this important point that you put up, Dr. Carlos, because indeed, for larger aggregates, you cannot even have the aggregate within the cylindrical radio. So you need to actually have a material model which has some of the larger aggregates, but the ones that are too large, they are removed, they are not considered. And so there is a great focus on the cement paste itself. There are some studies that compared the effect of the aggregate and the cement paste drying. So only drying the matrix without the aggregates and what happens with the aggregate. This work is actually the one that I got to know, the work of Professor Stefan Dapon, and it showed that there is an important effect because the aggregates themselves will have differences on thermal expansion from the matrix. And so there is cracking around this interfacial transition zone. And this is something that you're not able or capable of seeing on those samples that you are removing these aggregates. But in our case, we are a little bit luckier, as you said, we are using the aggregates that are a bit smaller, and we were capable of casting the same kind of 5-keg composition that are already used and described well in our laboratory group, which I think represents somewhat well the composition of real products in a way.
But no, the point that I'd like to mention is that first, when you use smaller aggregates, you are in the most critical part than when you use a large one. Because when you go to refractory application also, we can use very big aggregates like 20 millimeters. And when we have big pieces, we can use also this one, but as you focus on the smallest one or the traditional one, then every result that you have here, it will be much more critical than we could use in the some field application. And another point that I would like to, just for curiosity, and I'd like to have your opinion, is because here we are just treating the castable itself, But usually in application, we can have metal fibers and also some anchors that is also metallic. When we it's allowed to use any kind of metal also in this tomography, or it's a limitation?
Okay, at that point, I think I will not have the knowledge to say to you, because I'm not sure if we can have any kind of difficulties. I will say from what I saw and what Stefano and Alessandro told me is that for our concrete samples itself, there is one very critical point in which after the test, you needed to wait for the sample to radiatively decay. So I don't know, perhaps a more dense metal could have a lot of this radiative activation, and that could be somewhat a limitation. But other than that, I'm not really sure. I do know from the literature on the same equipment that we are using, some people studied the corrosion of steel reinforcement concrete. So I would think that there is not a limitation of the technique. I think they can use it from these works in the literature. But actually, when we were starting to work on these ideas of what we would like to see there, we were thinking, I think it was the idea of Professor Panunfelli, to actually try to see the interface of a metallic anchor or representative of an anchor during the drying. But we needed to select, because we have a limited availability on the equipment. So this is something that for now we are not capable of performing these studies. But for sure, maybe for the future as a postdoc, or if we are capable of having more tests at the synchrotron lab here on the serial, then perhaps we could try to pursue that as well.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's for me, it's a very interesting topic, and I think you have very nice friends to help you on this on this path. I have a very big expectation of this work, mainly because it's associating just not new techniques, but also approaching or questioning why the microwave is with a huge potential is not being used as a conventional heating, and we are just focused on something that started in the last centuries. And then I hope you could bring it, because it's not just two techniques, but also you are proposing a more systemic view of this approach, and I think it was very unique for drying of castable and this complexity and every challenges that comes from this work. Then I wish you all the best, and thanks again for the invitation. And I have just one curiosity that first. The number of the pages, did you see that? I don't know if it's the new procedure for the one, but I saw that the odds and the pars are in the different sides. It took me attention.
Actually, it was something that I wasn't paying too much attention, because I was more afraid of exceeding the limit of the 40 pages. But it's something that I needed to follow the graduate school formatation, which is to always start on the odd page and so on. But sorry, I didn't pay attention to that.
No, just as I mentioned, the work is so well approached that it's just a few details for the corrections. Then this is just more curiosity instead of pointing some mistakes, because I know that every manuscript has its own formatation. And just for me also to know if it's something that I have to comment or not. I think it was also positive. Then again, thanks so much for my invitation, and wish you all the best, Murilo.
Thank you very much, Dr. Carlos. They were very valid and good points to always keep in mind and to try to correct. And even for the qualification text itself, I will try to just put on the right pages the beginning of the chapters. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Okay, Dr. Carlos, thank you very much for your questions and your suggestions. So let's move to the Professor Ricardo. The second member of the exam committee. So, Ricardo, please make yourself comfortable.
Okay, thanks, Derek. First, thanks to Dofeli Murilo for inviting me for this qualification exam. It's a pleasure to be part of this committee. Also, my compliments to to Dr. Pagliosa and Professors Derek, Roberto. There is also listening to this presentation, and also Professor Stefan Dopo. So, Murilo, thanks for our presentation. I know that you have some limitations in the number of pages that you can use in the qualification text, but I can say at least your presentation is a little bit different from your text, okay? Several points that you have made during your presentation for me give you a better understand of your subject. Mainly because you have so many figures that can explain a little bit more some parts of our text. So, you have decided to study a complex phenomenon. And you try to use two different approaches, an experimental approach and also a computational one. For me, in my opinion, the experimental part is a PhD and the computational part is another PhD. So you have a big challenge to combine these approaches. We can say that you are using two advanced approaches. We are using an advanced approach for the experimental part and the other advanced approach for the computational part. So you have a big challenge, and I'm sure that you need to pay some attention with your schedule and your goals, and maybe you need to decide to cut some parts of your project. Okay. So we discuss a little bit about that. I have some knowledge of your research. Of course, I have some ideas and also questions. I have some questions regarding our presentation and the other questions regarding our text. So we'll change from one to another by convenience. So starting by our text, but of course, you can use also your presentation to answer that. You have a partition of the strain in equation 1.2.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
First comment, I think you can choose better the name of your variables because you have epsilon t on the left side and epsilon t on the right side. I know that you have the superscript and superscript, but to change, maybe it would be a good idea. Tell me a little bit more about the epsilon p parser.
Okay, just let me put here on this. Okay, so the epsilon p, okay, so just for the sake of this, actually, this is more of a simplified view of the total strain. There are some works that actually account for creep of the concrete and so on, but that is generally the civil engineering approach, and we do believe that it's more related to the dynamics of this kind of process, because it's a large structure that will spend a lot of time under heavy loads and so on, and because of that, it is an important aspect. For us, we are thinking and actually selecting these contributions for this strain just because, as I mentioned, we have a limited time and limited resources, and we want to focus on the facts that are the most important ones for us. So just as you mentioned here, the total strain can be decomposed on the strain of the elastic deformation due to the external loads. This is important for us as well because we're talking about large structures in the industries and so on. The T part here, second term, is the thermomechanical strains due to the thermal expansion of the solid. But the pressure part is the strain originated by the pressurization of the vapor within the porous medium. And we are making use of BO's framework of pressurization. The idea here is that this pressurization that occurs inside the pores is actually distributed on our volume and in our body. So in a way, it's a volumetric force that we are accounting for. And actually our code, our Phoenix code, is not based on the strains themselves, but we are actually considering the contributions to the formation of the Cauchy stress tensor from the strains. But basically is the that term of the kappa value, which we consider the effect of thermal expansion in the first and second Lamap parameters, and the temperature in the relation, the temperature difference between the temperature at the room with no strain and the temperature at the current heating stage.
Okay. Okay, thanks for your answer. I need to see more the equations that we're using this part, but I know that you have some limitations in the number of pages, and the also your presentation is more, I can see, graphic than the.
Yeah, I'm looking if I put it here, but I did not.
But you can discuss that after, okay?
Okay.
Because I think we will spend a little bit time. We can say some hours to discuss that. Okay, but Ingor, you have also answered Carlos about that, but we can say in the experimental approach you are using a technique that enables you to see what is happening for the AT36 and AT13 components. Is that? Or 3-1, sorry. But also your, so we can say that for the others, four granulometers that we have, you just have a continuum media, almost a continuum media, homogeneous media in tomography. But also you have some homogenized approach when you are using your computational model. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a good idea to make a figure that you combine the real material and also combine the experimental technique approach to show what is possible to see or not. And also the scale of your computational model. Because you have, in fact, the experimental approach and the computational approach works in a different scale of your material, which makes a little bit difficult to identify some parameters, but we can discuss that. Also, you, in our introduction, you discussed some strategies to improve the permeability, to reduce the pressure level, and try to avoid the explosive spalling. But the scale that these strategies is also, you can say, impossible to see.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me a little bit more about that.
Just to see if I'm capturing it right, you're talking about the scale of the polymeric fibers themselves.
Yes.
Okay. No, sure. Yeah, so this is something that we're really trying to propose, but it's still kind of a difficulty because let me just show here. Yeah, I think this figure can show a little bit better this hypothesis. I only mentioned it pretty quickly because we were running out of time, but actually there is some very large controversy of what is the mechanisms that leads to the permeability enhancing capabilities of polymeric fibers. I think I already even talked to you a little bit about that kind of models and analytical solutions. But the idea is that there are some people that say that the polymers, they will melt and then they will decompose due to the heating. And these will create open channels in this material from which water can escape from towards the environment. However, if that was the case, we could assume that a polymer that has a temperature of the composition that is very small will behave very well, because it is going to actually decompose earlier at lower temperatures, leaving those channels, especially for the ebullition phase of the drying, which is one of the most critical ones. However, empirically, by using the thermogravimetry analysis that we have here equipment, we can apply very large heating rates, and then it's not even more a rather test of mass measurement, but at actually explosion test, as we call. And then we could see that actually even polymers that have a very small temperature of the composition and melting, they were not behaving as well as the polypropylene fibers. And so in the literature, some people explain this because they say, well, actually what happens is that the polymeric fiber will expand, try to expand more than your castable, and then it will lead to cracks. Okay, we can observe that on these electron microscopy figures. And we can see that we have very small values here. So it's, perhaps a 30 micron fiber here. But what we observed is, well, okay, these figures, they are obtained post-mortem, I mean, after the drying. And to see these surfaces, they actually cut it. So, okay, can we be sure that this cracking occurred during the drying, during the heating, or if it is something else? And this is the appeal of using an in-situ visualization technique. However, I know that you will say that there is a limitation of the spatial resolution of this technique. And so what we are thinking of doing is to actually select some polymeric fibers that have a larger thickness. With that in hand, then we could actually visualize a little bit better. The microcracking is something that we are not capable of visualizing, at least with the technique and the tomography that we are going to use at the Institute Laue-Langevin. But we hope to see at least some effect on the water content on the regions around of this. And if, for instance, we could observe some positions in which we have a faster drying than the others, maybe we could correlate to the existence of these and perhaps perform some electron microscopy on those cases. But it's something that in a moment, we do believe that we're not capable of observing. But then it starts to go together in this collaboration with the synchrotron lab. Their resolution is way finer than what we can achieve in the X-ray tomography of Institut Laue-Langevin. And perhaps then we could actually observe at least the cracking. Perhaps we are losing information about the water distribution, but we could see if this formation of cracks is in situ or not. And then we could try to go from there to validate those hypotheses in the literature and so on. But we are taking into consideration this, especially because there is a part of the proposal of the tests at Institut Laue-Langevin that we needed to address the feasibility of what we want to see regarding these limitations on spatial resolution and so on. And this is what we are trying to use that technique that I mentioned for Dr. Carlos, of having higher resolution in the beginning and in the end of the test. Perhaps we could see some features, I don't know if the micro cracks, but if there are larger cracks, perhaps we could see it. But it's something that we are not completely covered and say, oh, we are definitely going to see these micro cracks.
Murilo, just one question. What's the resolution? Is the spatial resolution that you have in Sidious Mogno?
Okay, in Sidious, it's a little more complex because they have two different stages of the equipment. they can go for nano resolution, so submicrons, I think on the range of 0.5 microns, so very fine. But then you sacrifice not only the acquisition time, but it's actually very fast due to the high intensity of the X-ray. But the most important is that you are actually sacrificing your field of view of the sample. Mm-hmm. And so we are talking about samples in the range of only some millimeters.
Because of the beam power?
Because of the technique, of the projection technique that they are using. Because they are putting the X-rays in a conical lenses, and then they are approximating these samples, and the field of view is very small, is very stricted. And this projection is actually the amplification that you can see for the microstructure and so on. They are not using an active lenses to obtain those fine resolutions. They say it's a cheaper way, it's faster, and they can change a little bit this from the distance of the beam source with respect to your sample. And with larger distances, you can cover a larger field of view, you lose some of the resolution, and then you go to the macro line, which is the new equipment that they have, because they have already commissioned the nano line, and now we are in the micro line. They are finishing the commissioning it, and then they are talking about 10 microns as the resolution. It's 30 microns, so it's a very small resolution. I don't have the precise values, and actually not even then, because there is so they can say, well, we could have it, but there is a very large signal to noise ratio, so we needed to actually sacrifice a little bit. So I think it's they're still discovering it, the limits of the equipment.
Okay, let's start to talk about your experimental part concerning the Newton tomography test. Please, can you show the figure that you have showing the drying process? The drying evolution, in fact.
Okay, maybe this one?
No.
This one, okay.
Yes, it's better.
Okay.
So, how is it possible to manufacture the specimens in Brazil and to send it to France to perform some tests that concerns some the drying process? That's the first question.
Okay, yeah. What we actually did was to obtain the samples here already casted in this ceramic casing. And this was important because from the mass loss evolution, we did not measure that as it was a preliminary test, and we did not define a precise protocol. And so we were not capable of making these mass changes. We sent a lot of samples, and the idea was that, okay, we have the mass loss after heating until 800 degrees Celsius here in Brazil, and we would compare these values with what they measured there at Grenoble. But the challenge was that we were not thinking exactly on that, because as I mentioned, these were only preliminary tests, so we were not thinking on the details of how to guarantee what is the water that we lose in the transport. To be sure, we are going to lose some water. We are using, I think, 5 plastic bags on the samples. But still, when we're talking about water vapor, the plastic bag is a porous net, so they can still escape from it. But we do believe that by using the ceramic casing, we are already reducing the surface area of the sample in contact with the environment. And also, we are only going to have water losses in the beginning and on in the end. What I can say to you is that visually, we are not seeing a large difference. I plotted some lines on the axial direction, and if we expected to have a intense drying, we could expect that on this surface, we would have a notorious difference of the intensity here than what we have on the bottom. But that was not exactly the case. So maybe I could try to argue and say, oh, look at that, we are not losing that much water. But still, it is a challenge. Not only on the drying, to be sure, the drying myself, I'm not really concerned about the water that we're losing on the transport. Okay, we're losing by evaporation. It will be something. I don't know if it's something that we can measure. Perhaps with the mass loss, we're only going to see a marginal difference. To me, the most important aspect is the curing, because the curing is an ongoing process.
We know that the hydration reactions that occur with refractory castable is not like directly the product of these precipitation dissolution mechanisms, because after these we have a lot of phase conversions depending on the amount of hydrates that we have on that. So it's a process that depends on temperature and on the time of the curing. So what I say to you is that this material, after 1 or 2 or even 3 weeks from going from Brazil to France, is not exactly the material that we would see in the drying if we made the test right after curing for 24 hours, because there will be changes. I already measured here for thermogravimetry tests, and I could see that a sample that had 1 day after curing, or 1 week after curing, or 2 weeks after curing, it would behave differently due to these phase conversions that are happening during the aging of the sample. But it's something that is difficult to solve, because, for instance, we do not have the raw materials in France. We have some partners that I don't know if they are willing to let me use their laboratory. So it's more complex because it's involving industries and so on. So as an initial test, we would like to, okay, understand it's a limitation of the experimental technique, but we do not have a clear way to solve it. So we are not, we are just going to try to account for it. And this is why I'm telling that all the, especially the quantitative analysis that we are performing, is normalized by the initial state of the sample, and understanding that it's not the same as after curing proceeding with the drying, right?
Okay, so the basic idea is to prepare all your specimens 1 week before to go to reference. Okay.
Good idea.
Okay. So show me again the slide 17, please.
Okay, sure.
I have some questions also about the concerning also the Newton tomography. So you can see some snapshots for 0, 15, 23 minutes. How much time take, what's the duration of a full scan?
Sorry?
What's the duration of a full scan? Because you have the turntable, you perform almost 300. Is 300 scans, I suppose. I'm not sure.
From the back of my head, I think it is, yeah, actually 180, if I'm not mistaken. But actually, we perform all the scans three times. So we actually have the average of three scans of each angle that we are running through.
Okay.
The total time that it takes, if I'm not mistaken, is 58.5 seconds to perform these three scans in all the angles of analysis. So it's in the range of 1 minute. Roughly, we have one tomography for each minute. I selected those times only just to present the data. But yeah, that's it. It's 1 minute for the excision.
Okay, because in fact your specimen is changing during the scan.
Yes. This is something that myself, I believe, I never got to talk with Alessandro or even Professor Stefan about it, but I do believe it's some of the reason why we have this kind of noise here, because those points, they are probably moving a little bit in their water content. But what we do know is that in the first 10 minutes, the sample is not changing. So the initial state is actually the median of the 10 first tomographies. And then we compare them with the each time step to obtain this relative difference.
Okay. I'm not sure that you have this figure in your presentation. It's the figure 9 of your text. I'm not sure if you have showed this figure 9.
Okay, yeah, I don't have it.
So the basic idea is, if you see the slide 17, is that? And we compare with this figure, we can see, for instance, that at the end of 60 minutes, for the no case in case, set, you have a dry percentage of 50%, almost 50%.
Okay.
In the right figure. Okay?
Okay, okay, this one.
Yes. It's possible to... So you have a measure that comes from the segmentation process, the image analysis, and so on. But you have measured the weight of your specimen at the end of the tomography test?
No, we did not. And this is something that we are planning on doing.
Actually, yes.
The desire of our to actually have the mass loss during the test.
Oh, perfect.
But that's not that easy because all the setup is rotating. And each one of these movements could affect the mass readings. And also, we need to account that there is the cables that we needed to consider. And on the case of the Newton tomography, it's not any equipment that we can put inside of it. There are some materials that will absorb too much, the neutrons. And so it's not directly easy to obtain that. If I would spend like 1 year in France, perhaps we would be able to try to create a new setup to perform this kind of analysis. As that is not the case, perhaps we are going to use what we have right now, as you mentioned, perform a mass measurement before and in the end, because then we have at least the initial and the end. For the setup that we are working and preparing for the synchrotron analysis, then we believe that we are going to be capable of measuring the mass. There are some difficulties as well, a little bit different from the difficulties of the Newton tomography tests, but we aim to actually try to measure this mass evolution, because then we could actually correlate what we are seeing with what we are measuring and say, okay, it is indeed this drying that is happening or not.
Okay, because it's not clear for me now. Mm-hmm. You can see reading our text and regarding our presentation and pay attention in our presentation, that how the measure the parts of your work can integrate themselves, you know. So this part in particular gives you different boundary conditions for your computational model. This figure in particular gives you two special cases that can analyze in using one-dimensional and two-dimensional finite element models.
Okay.
You have just described the mechanical part of your work in your text. So I need to put this question: how many parameters do you need to calibrate to use your ergothermal mechanical model?
Yes. So this is another aspect. You can go as complex as you want. So, for instance, if you want to consider all the different phases and have a multi-phase model, as was described on my master dissertation, then you would need to rely on almost 25 to 30 different parameters. Our strategy is to use a monophasic model, which reduces a lot. So we're talking about 80 parameters. So 80 parameters that we need for describing the thermal Higgory state of the model. If we account on those properties, such as the enthalpy of evaporation of water, then we go to 9 parameters. But still, it's way smaller. But then the mechanical aspects, we will need to account for the Young modules. We will need to consider the Poisson effect and the critical energy release rate, which can be obtained by the combination of the Young modules and the intrinsic toughness of the material.
Okay, that is also a question. Because you have 9 parameters that comes from thermal model, and they also have 2 parameters for the mechanical part. For me, it's clear that the 2 parameters of the mechanical part, it's possible to identify using mechanical tests. Okay. But I don't know about the 9 parameters that you have to identify concerning the thermal Higgory part. I suppose that some of these parameters is possible to measure using conventional techniques. And another part where you are just using some inverse technique to identify this parameter.
Exactly.
Okay. So just comment a little bit about how many parameters you have is possible to identify using conventional techniques and how many parameters you have to identify using various techniques.
Okay. So the main challenges are three of the parameters because we already performed the sensitive analysis. And so we saw that the effect of the density of the material, the porosity is not that large in comparison to the permeability values, the thermal conductivity, and the sorption isotherm. So these three, it's a complex set of properties. The thermal conductivity, we can have some measurements here in our laboratory, but at samples that were dried. Sorry, I think you are muted, but
I'm just thinking.
Okay, but yeah. So the thermal conductivity is a challenge by itself, but from some literature measurements and from what we saw from some models that are mostly semi-empirical from the civil engineering, we see that the thermal conductivity doesn't change that much. We are talking about a range of 5 to 15 watts per meter Kelvin. So, okay, sure, they are changing, but like it's not changing from 5 to 50 or 5 to 500. Okay. But then it leads us with two properties that are very important and very difficult to measure. First one is the permeability, and the second one is the sorption isotherm. I'll go by parts. The permeability, the issue is that the material is behaving in a very dynamic way. And not only that, but the material itself is a mass source. So for instance, the traditional Darcy method or Saint-Bourreau method of measuring the intrinsic permeability by applying a temperature gradient on your sample, a pressure gradient, sorry, and then measuring the mass flow and so on, is not able of capturing this dynamic nature because you are not ever having a steady state during the drying, because you're having evaporation and you're having the hydration, and these mass sources are occurring at different moments related to the temperature history. So what is done currently is to measure the permeability at room temperature conditions after some thermal treatments. So for instance, I put my sample in the oven at 200 degrees Celsius, I wait for 24 hours, I go to the other day, remove it, wait for it to arrive at the room temperature, and measure the intrinsic permeability. This is the method that we applied during my internship at the Medis company, and it's, I think, one of the ones that you can do. But the issue is that we are not having that information of the mass release and so on. So within Tullio's master, he developed with Professor Panonfelli a correlation of the intrinsic permeability measurement with the mass flux readings from those tests of the high temperature permeometer. And it's important to say it's a permeometer and not a permeability measurement equipment, because we're only going to see the mass flow as a function of the temperature. We're never going to try to correlate the pressure gradient with the velocity to obtain intrinsic permeability, but we're at least capable of seeing at which time we are having mass removal and so on, and also when we have increase of mass release and a decrease of it. The idea is to try to combine this with the permeability of with the Newton tomography analysis. There are some conditions that are shared between these techniques. So for instance, we are having cylindrical samples and so on, but they have different sizes, different thicknesses. So there is not a direct relationship between them, or a correlation, as you prefer. So what we try to do is to actually see if we're capable of using an inverse method to obtain the permeability through the Newton tomography test. This is one of the ideas. But we are exploring some analysis that try to use the reconstruction of the porous network of our sample to obtain the intrinsic permeability from it. Not an easy task, especially because we have a lot of closed pores. So how you account for that?
And they also have some problems concerning the spatial resolution.
Naturally, yes, this is going to always hunt us. But we want to try to see if we can apply one of these techniques to correlate them, and then see, and at the end, we would have perhaps three measurements of the permeability, or at least indirect indications of the value of the permeability. So the one from the permeability measurements, traditional one at room temperature, one from the inverse analysis of the Newton tomography test, and another one from this analysis of the pore structure of the material. Hopefully, we would try to complement those data with the permeameter values and then correlate and see what is the one that is better reproducing these results and these findings on permeameter tests. But then again, the issue is that besides the permeability, we do not know the moisture, sorption isotherm. The sorption isotherm, which is the state variable that will say to us the amount of adsorbed water on the surface of the pores. We do not have this information. So perhaps if we do the inverse analysis, we will have a combined effect of the permeability with the sorption isotherm itself. And this is why it is so important to try to obtain the permeability through these other methods, to actually try to isolate these tests. But it's not an easy feature. It's something that...
Okay. So in this sense, it's very important for our thesis, you show some sensitivity analysis. So you need to change the parameters and to show that these parameters correspond to a different part of your macroscopic behavior. And then you try to use some tests with some specific response to identify this. So what we're going to use to identify, you're using 11 biomarker algorithm, you're using some genetic algorithm. That is important also to describe what's your strategy concerning the inverse analysis. Okay.
So regarding this inverse analysis, it is something that actually we are a little bit behind of schedule. I would like to already start working on that before going for my internship, but then it was not something that we were capable of doing. So it is something that we are actually still going to plan on doing. And actually, it's something that we would like a lot to listen from you a little bit, because it's something that we know that you have more experience on the inverse analysis. I never needed one of them. Perhaps something that we already did on some tests were more manual changes on the property. But as I think you know, by using genetic algorithm or these other methods, we can reduce dramatically the time to obtain the property well. But at the moment, we do not have exactly fixed a strategy for this part of the work.
Okay. In my opinion, in particular, you need to cut the part concerning the microwave analysis or the microwave heating, because it's a complex part of our work, and maybe I think it's better to get deeper in the experimental and the computational approaches without this part, okay? But that is my opinion. So you need to discuss that with Pandolfelli and Professor Stefan Dalpon, okay? Just to see if I have more questions. What about the heating of your specimen during the tomography tomographic tests?
Sure, yeah. Actually, it is performed. I don't think I have this figure in a direct way, but actually the heater is a small infrared heater plate that is on this top part here of the Newton tomography system.
So you have also a thermal gradient in your specimen.
Yes.
Yeah. To measure that?
That is a great challenge, because when we put some thermocouples on the sample, well, first we have technical challenges of putting these thermocouples within the ceramic casing that we're putting it. What we know from earlier results of some students of Professor Stefano Dalpon is that even the mere presence of a capillary thermocouple, very thin one, can already dramatically change the microstructure. It can lead to stabilization of bubbles on there, which will create a path for water leaking and so on. So it is something that we are not actively measuring right now, Perhaps it's something that can be done, but we do not need it to perform in the neutron test. We can do that in a separate sample with these different thermocouples. Then again, we know that these changes will have an effect, but we expect that they will not be as big as the node measuring itself. But the temperature profiles is not something that we are too terrified about, because it's pretty easy to obtain a similar temperature evolution with the thermal conductivity measurements and so on. So it is something that we know that it can be challenging to have an accurate representation. But in the moment, what we are thinking on doing is to actually use the numerical model to show this temperature evolution and try to correlate of what is happening at such positions and so on.
Yeah, my question is, because you are trying to calibrate your computational model to simulate the drying process that you are observing in the neutron thermography. So it's important to have information about another field, you know? Okay. Just compare the what region is dry and the region that's wet. Maybe you have some a complete anomalous behavior concerning the temperature or concerning the stress distribution that is not possible to see. So I don't know if it's possible to use some non-intrusive measurements. So it's possible maybe to measure the temperature using a infrared sensor or something like that you can use external from the main chamber, you know? So, just say this. Concerning now your computational model, please can you show me your slide 27?
27, oh, right, here we have it. Sorry, it's way too zooming.
Okay. Yes. For me, it will be very important to see the figure that we can see the load versus displacement, or the force versus displacement. Okay. You need to add in your model some unloading to see what is happening. Okay. We need to see your model loading and unloading, and after loading again and unloading. To get some idea of what is happening concerning the damage variable.
Mm-hmm.
Also, yeah, I think it's better to use the term, the verb compare, instead of validate for the comparison with Hamahan. Hamahan, is that?
Yeah, Hahaman, yeah.
Hahaman.
Sorry. I don't know the pronunciation.
Okay, yeah. Concerning the Hahaman model, okay? Mm-hmm. So you use, I read in your text that you were using the same mesh, the same discretization that he used, but it's possible for you to run this result, to run his script, sir?
Yes, the Julie script, yes, I can run, because actually this is why I selected his work.
Yeah, so it's possible to compare node by node the answer?
Yes. It's,
okay, yeah. So the best idea is to compare the displacement field, the stress field, node by node, the displacement field you compare node by node, but the stress field you compare compare the Gauss points that you have in Hahaman model and your model, okay? To plot the norm of the difference, for me, it would be better that to show the force versus displacement graph.
Okay.
And last question. Tell me a little bit about the thermal gradient that you have in your TGA tests. Because you are using just a thermocouple to tell you that the temperature of the specimen is something, but you have 300 millimeters by 300 millimeters by 300 millimeters cubed.
No, you're right. Actually, it's something that I didn't mention in it, but actually what they do in reality, I don't know if we can see here right well, but actually there are three thermocouples. So you have at three different positions. I know it's still not perfect. We are not obtaining all of this data, but we could see
at what are the positions?
They are, I have a figure in which I plotted, but it's another place. But it's actually, there is the one that I'm using, which is right in the middle of the sample. Oh yeah, in the center of this face, but in the center of the book. And there is one that is, I think if I'm remember correcting, 5 centimeters up and 5 centimeters down, all orientated on the center of the top surface. So it is something, for sure, they cannot guarantee that it is exactly that position, but it is some measurements. And we can see indeed that there are some changes on the temperature readings of that of those thermocouples. I'm thinking from remembering, we are talking about 10 degrees Celsius of difference. It's not that high, I think, due to the very small heating rate. For sure, if we started to apply higher heating rates, we would have a larger thermal gradient. But one interesting feature that I just mentioned, but didn't mention a lot, was this kink on this temperature increase values of the sample. We could see on the center thermocouple, but this was not observed for the other thermocouples. And we do believe that this is related to the condensation of water at the innermost position and the sudden evaporation once we reach the critical temperature of the water. And all of that water is consumed and it's becoming vapor, consuming a lot of thermal energy. And this is why we have this decrease of the temperature heating of the sample. So it's an interesting aspect, but more aspects of perhaps having 5 thermocouples or something like that, I think that they are limited by the data acquisition system. So I don't think they can do that in a single test.
Okay, but you have 3, it's better than 1.
Sure.
Okay?
Yeah.
And maybe also this information can also be useful to calibrate your model, you know?
Sure, yeah.
Pay attention because you have another kind of, we can say, load. So you have another kind of response. Maybe this can give you another procedure to identify some parameters.
Okay.
These were my questions. You have a big challenge. Good luck. And I really think that you need to exclude some parts of your research. You know, you need to discuss about that. So, Derek, it's up to you. Thank you, Murilo.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Ricardo. Those are very valuable comments and questions. So I'm sure Murilo took notes of that. So I believe it's my turn now. So Dr. Carlos and Ricardo did a very good job commenting on your thesis and your work, Murilo. So first, I would like to thank you to invite me to be part of your exam committee. So Professor Panofello, thank you as well. I've been part of your master's exam committee, right? And I remember your work during the master's degree. So it was a quite a big thesis. And I could see that you did a lot of work and a lot of effort doing your master's. So at that time, I thought you were in your best performance, but reading now the your PhD proposal, I could feel that you are just warming up. Now you are in a game. So what I mean with that, so the amount of work here presented or that's being proposed is a lot, right? So there are technological problems coupled with scientific approaching as well. So it's very interesting, okay? What I would comment on that is that I'm sure that you have, I'm impressed that you have a lot of collaborators, right? So in slide 7, I guess, you showed the professors that you are working with. So you are working with all these partners, all of these professors, right?
Not directly. I mean, on here in this slide, I tried to merge the drawing initiatives on our laboratory group with what I'm doing right now. So for instance, I have direct connections with Professor Murilo Innocentini, Professor Stefan Dalpon, Rodolfo Hong, and Roberto Alves. Professor Caio, for instance, is more a partnership with other master and PhD students. But I think we can try to work together on these once we try to understand better these mechanisms of permeability increase. But yeah, generally speaking, these are the collaborations of the PhD project.
Okay, great. So yeah, that's a really interesting thing. So you are looking for collaborators to help you to develop your project. So that's impressive. I think most of the PhD students should do that, but sometimes the profile of the characteristics of the person, they don't. But it's a good point. If it starts from you, it is a very, very nice thing to look at. I like the scheme of your project objective you put here. Okay. I understand that in case of your proposal here, you are limited in terms of pages, right? So you have a very short number of pages to put a lot of information. And then I see that you did it quite well. Okay, so even though you have like practically 50 pages to put, 60 pages to put a lot of this of your work, you did it very succinct, but still it's here, right? Even the experimental results, you managed to put it in your proposal. That's good. Okay, that's very interesting. Of course, because of the time, you I feel that the text is a little bit short, right? But I understand that you're going to develop it more in your thesis. That's normal. Okay, I'm not pissed off with that. I encourage you to put a clear objective. I like the drawing. Okay, I like the scheme, but as you did in the presentation for the thesis, put this in the discuss a little bit more about that. Okay, so just a comment. So I'll overall the thesis here, the document. So in the introduction, I like how you started the introduction. Okay, you took care to, you were concerned to talk a little bit about the environmental problem. That's good, but you also introduce the technological advantages of the materials you are developing. So, and it came first. That's good to see. So I've been participating of a lot of qualify exams. I think have dozen of from 2 months from now, and all of them has this motivation. The environmental part of the motivation, and they are forgetting the technological and economic part of that. I mean, it's good to have the concern about the environment, but we can't forget also the technological part. So, and you put it here, it's nice, okay? and then you direct went to the challenge that you are facing here. That's good. Okay. And then you move to the literature review. What I find interesting in your text that is that you start the even the introduction also, but the literature review, you start to write and you don't have subjective. You have just the literature review and then you write it down as a flow, like less. As a even less like a chapter of a book. So there's no 2.1, 2.11, 2. That's very nice. Very nice, and it seems that you are pretty confident with what you are organizing, how you are organizing the ideas here, and you are showing here. Okay. Just one side comment on this. It's in my perspective. Okay. When you mention Moreira, it is you, right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. No, that's fine. But if it is your job, if it is your work, the work you have been developing, I think I encourage you to. So in my work or in our work, in our laboratory work, we have been developing stuff. So, like you compare multi-phase models and you have a published article about that. So don't put you as another like search author, right? Just when it is yours, it is yours. You mentioned it, okay? You already did it, okay? that's all I have to talk about the text. What else? Yeah, so I mean, it is a short. It's short, so we'll have all lots of information that you could reference. It would be nice to see here because it's kind of annoying. You have to go to the reference, you know, and then I don't have access to the article. Oh my god! So well, never mind. I'll see. I'll take a look at that later. It happened with me, but I know that you're limited in the space. That's okay. So. Dr. Carlos and Professor Ricardo did already a very good job on talking about the neutron diffraction and all this like crazy stuff. So I will pass to that. Okay. First thing, Murilo. So what is the most challenging part of this work?
Okay. So thank you very much, Professor Eric, for your comments on the writing on the text and also on this aspect. Regarding the subject itself, I think this slide helps a lot. I think the most complex and difficult part is to bind all of them together. I am pretty happy that you mentioned that part of the fundamental review on the bibliography review that I tried to not compartmentalize, but create a single chapter. It took a lot of time for that. And I'm saying this because it is, I think, the most biggest challenge of this project, because it's difficult to put everything together in the same framework. And as you mentioned, if you have all of these collaborations, it's always good, it's always nice. As Dr. Carlos mentioned, it's good to have a lot of friends, but at the same time, it's difficult to be present with all of these different friends. You know, all of them will give you good insights, ideas, but it's always difficult to keep up with the expectations and also to actually have the time to implement those ideas and suggestions. So what we are trying to do in our laboratory with the good guidance of Professor Panunfelli is to try to not only have partners, but also have people that will focus more on that. So for instance, the microwave drawing, I am actually just helping the undergrad research student to work on that. So Fernando is working directly with the hands in the project itself. I'm not directly doing all the effort. But for sure, it's a good opportunity to train new people and so on, but it takes some time as well. So I understand the suggestion of Professor Ricardo to try to have a more focused aspect on the in situ observations and the model itself. With that being said, besides these difficulties on how to organize all of this team effort, I think the in situ observation availability is the biggest change. So the Newton tomography is very it's a very interesting technique, but we face a lot of competition to use it, and we would like to perform more tests. So I think it's something that we need to be with our feet on the ground and understand that we are not going to have a lot of multiple tests, but we want to select the ones that will make a good advance on the understanding of the subject. But then again, I feel secure because this biggest challenge is in good hands with Professor Stefano Dalpon and even Dr. Alessandro Tengatini. They make available, even if the project itself is not granted time and the equipment, we will try to have some other opportunities at some non-conventional times to actually just use a little bit of equipment, try to gather some interesting insights from it and run some tests. But it is something that we are trying to actively have this collaboration with the people from the Sirius Lab, not to substitute these neutron tomography tests because there are different techniques, but to complement them and to actually be able to put in practice some of the interesting ideas, such as Dr. Carlos mentioned several of them that we want to pursue, but with the given time and with the right maturity level to do so. So I think this is generally speaking, the put it. The thermomechanical stresses model, to me, it's a little bit challenging because in the beginning of the PhD project, I had little to no knowledge on the mechanical aspects. So I needed to learn a lot. Professor Roberto Alzas has been amazing on this, on helping to understand the equations and helping to have a physical intuition about it then and so on. And on the numerical aspects as well, Professor Ricardo himself helped it a little bit on this. But it's something that is, as I said, in good hands. So I'm not really as afraid as I am from the in-situ observations, because it doesn't depend only on us. It depends on a third-party evaluation of our proposal and so on. And I think this is it.
Okay, Murilo. So in this case,
Sorry, Professor Derek, I think you're muted.
Okay, I just pressed here, but it didn't work. So thank you, Murilo, for your answer. So in this case, it is very nice you have a lot of projects going on in your PhD, okay? And you have it, but usually as a suggestion, okay? So for you and Professor Nofel as well. I would divide it in the crucial projects, that the projects that you have to present at the end, okay, to get your PhD. And you could put all the projects as a side projects, but not less important, but side projects, okay. And the project that you are developing together with your main thesis.
Okay.
Maybe, I don't know, maybe it is more like easier to present, and you can go into the details more accurately in your thesis. So I know that because you are developing a lot of different, you are working on a lot of different fronts, you want to show, right? You want to show that you are working a lot and then you are getting good results. So yeah, that's fine, but don't worry. So you'll be recognized of that. You're going to publish papers, you're going to publish with all of these professors, and you're going to get the contacts network, and probably by the end of your PhD, you're going to have a pretty brilliant career, right? So, but mean, think about that, okay? So put try to make a core, like a thesis core, like this is my, I have to have it, okay? And then the side projects will incorporate your thesis, but it's not the like principle, okay? The main thing, okay?
Okay.
It's a suggestion, okay? That's how I see things, but it's your call.
I think you're again muted.
Oh, that's weird.
Strange, yeah.
Okay, so let's go. So Murilo, let's move to the preliminary results. Now it's a curiosity. It is a like a question from the person that doesn't work with the technology, okay? So you talked about the size, right? The representative size of your sample, all these things. And for your tests, even the neutron or other tests, the format, shape of your sample, is it also important? You think that this can give you different results, or how do you evaluate it?
Okay, just to comment first, Professor Derek, thank you very much for your suggestion. I think it's a very important one and a good idea on how to handle these ongoing parallel projects. But regarding the geometry of the samples, yes, in the literature, we do have some studies that show the effect of changing some of the geometries. I have seen some comparing prisms with cylinders and so on. But basically, I think the what is happening is that different geometry will have different surface area. And as the moisture flux is passing through these different areas, when we are talking about a higher ratio between the surface area and volume, we are probably having an easier drawing than if we have geometry such as a cube that doesn't have that great amount of surface area, such as a cylinder. But then again, it's quite difficult to separate those effects of the moisture aspects, moisture transfer aspects, such as the surface area, but as well as the thermal gradients inside the sample, which we know that dictates exactly how the drying occurs on the first and second drying stages of evaporation and ebullition. So this is something that we do know. We try to favor a little bit the cylindrical samples, such as in the TJ case and on the neutron tomography. On the case of the neutron tomography, I think Professor Stefano can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that you needed to have a cylinder because of the rotations and the back projection algorithms to reconstruct your surface. So I think it's easier to have axisymmetric volume. But
radial symmetry, right?
Yes, radial symmetry. Yeah, that was the right term that I was looking for. But on the other tasks, or on the other tests, for instance, these ones of the size scale from Elkin, they only have a large mold for cube. So we are quite limited to that. They are making smaller cubes of intermediary sizes, but we do know that they are not going to be on the cylindrical aspects. But for the TJ, it's not that big of an issue. For instance, something that perhaps we will do is to cast our sample in a cube mode. We would need to prepare it, but then we could try to compare these effects, the geometry effect, for TGA analysis. I think it's a new topic. I've never seen someone doing that stuff, but perhaps it could be interesting. I myself am not even sure if in our laboratory group, perhaps someone already made these kind of studies. I would need to search a little bit better on that. But it's a good point that you mentioned.
Okay. Yeah, well, just a thought that I, when you were presenting, came to my mind. So it looks like the shape of the samples is not quite the same. But if it is a variable, you can comment on that, right? Like you did. So, but you have limitation, right? I mean, it's not. In figure, just another quick comment, in figure 8, I know that what this means, okay, but it's if you read by just read, like without interpretation, what difference means? It's a difference of what? Okay. Difference in humidity, difference in, okay?
Okay.
So, yeah, take a look on that. Okay. Just one moment. Okay. Size effect. Yeah. That's you mentioned the size effect, so you could put the shape effect also. So let's go about the figure 13, the TGA experiment. So I'll just do a couple of questions there, and then we can move on. You showed the difference that when you are varying the heating rate, you are getting a better convergent result. That's what I tried to show you, right?
Yes.
Okay. So what is the reason of this convergence when you go to a higher heating rate?
Okay. So I think it will help a little bit better if I just use this image here.
Okay. Yes, that's figure 13. Yeah, that's the image.
Okay. So yeah, the point here is that what happens from our understanding is that when we are changing this volume, we are going to change the thermal gradient that develops inside this sample. Due to the fact that we have a different characteristic length for the heat wave to travel within it. There are some quantities that people can calculate. There is a characteristic time of heating, which is calculated by the thermal diffusivity times this characteristic length, and which increases as you increase the sample. And so we could explain this difference in thermal gradients by even applying the same heating rate, but with samples of different geometry.
Yes.
Another effect is the heating rate itself. As we increase the heating rate, we are actually not giving enough time to do what is called as thermally soak the sample, which is to provide enough energy for the sample to start heating with the same heating rate dictated by the specific heat and the characteristic thermal inertia of the sample. This heating rate effect is the opposite of the volume effect. So if we increase the volume but decrease the heating rate, we can compensate these effects. I was thinking, but it was like last week, I'm not sure, I prefer to not put in the presentation, if I could calculate this characteristic length and the heating rate and correlate those quantities to show that we are actually having a compensation effect on the thermal gradient by changing the heating rate and the volume at the same time.
Yes.
But I think this is why we are having this good match in the evaporation and ebullition phase, because we are seeing that those drying stages, they are dominated by the thermal gradients that are developing inside the sample. When we arrive to the dehydratation, then the figure changes, because dehydratation is a chemical transition that is thermally activated and directly depends on the drying, on the heating rate that you have. We know from TGA understanding that if we increase too much the heating rate, we can shift some transition temperatures to smaller temperatures. And I think this is what we see with these higher heating rates and with the pressure and the measurement peaks that we see here on slide 33. As we can see here on this contribution of the peaks here related to the dehydration.
You can expand the explanation in this from these results in your thesis as you did now. Okay. Are you using this percent?
Yes, we are using.
Is it polymeric?
Yes, let me just put here on I think we have on the table, we have been using the FS60 casement dispersant.
Okay, so it's gonna burn, right?
Yes, we are not sure if we are capable of seeing that on the TGA, but I think there was one study of a master student, Tamiris Milagres, that made some analysis on that aspect as well. Mm-hmm. But I don't remember if it was something that we could see on the TGA or not.
Well, 0.2% in rate might be measurable.
Okay.
Measurable. because it's, if you think about a small sample, okay, that's not much weight. When you go to a big sample, that's a lot of material.
when you go, you mentioned here, right? The big TGA is about 8 kilograms, right?
Yes, yes.
8 kilograms. So 0.2%, we're talking about what?
400 grams, I think.
400, so half kilogram of this material.
Yes, yes, it's a lot, yeah.
Burning, okay. And that comes to my second question about the TGA result. So in the page 36, you mentioned some calculation of energy required to increase temperature. So in one degree. It's almost use definition for CP, but let's go there. So you put some values here, 9.78, whereas to micro TGA, 6.7%. How did you calculate it?
Okay, yeah, actually it was by using the specific heat, times the density of the material, times the volume. So it was actually to see that what would be the energy necessary to increase by 1 degree Celsius, the volume of that sample. So
the whole sample, right?
The whole sample, right, yeah, yeah, that's the thing.
Okay, so let me get it right. So you have the CP of your sample,
mm-hmm.
and then you calculate it, but you're losing, right? You're losing water, right? What happens with the thermal coefficient, conduction coefficient, and with CP?
Yeah, that is a good point, because it depends on what you're measuring it. If you are measuring the specific heat of the overall sample with saturation of water, it will be following the mixture laws of some contributions of the water that you have inside of it, which has a very large specific heat, and the alumina aggregates and the cassibo itself, which is roughly 4 times smaller than this water content. For the modeling, we are separating those effects, but in reality, when we measure those values, we are measuring them together. So if we do a measurement of the CP of a sample that is saturated, we would see a decrease of the CP as you increase the temperature. But we do not perform those analyses because we have to actually first dry the sample before moving to the DCT equipment that we have here on our laboratory. Due to the dangers of having an explosion and destroying the equipment, so this is why we always dry. But for this estimative, I was using the CP of the dry sample multiplied by the density of the sample and the volume. I think I should be more clear on this on the text, even though I mentioned a little bit that we are neglecting the energy necessary for water removal, but I think it's not really clear what I am doing on these calculations. I think I should explain a little better this, right?
Yeah, so it's quite confusing because neglecting the energy necessary for water removal, but you want to remove water, right?
Yes, yes, yes.
So what I would suggest, forget about CP. You know what you can do? Mm-hmm. Take a piece of your sample, put inside a DSC, and measure the heating of curve heating, and then you calculate the enthalpy of this. Pretty much you have all the energy input you put in for the thermal transformations that occur in your sample. There are thermal transformations. There are water, like physical bounded water, chemical, because it's hydraulic, that are chemical bonded water, and then probably you have some phase transformation, crystalline, I don't know, maybe you have it, I don't know. There's a lot of stuff happening there, and it means that it changes over the time,
mm-hmm.
and also the conduction, the thermal conduction of the material changes also over the time as you have the thermal transformations, which can maybe
Sorry, it's muted again, Professor. Sorry. Okay.
Again, okay. So I meant that the thermal conduction of your material, the conductivity of your material changes also over the thermal degradation, right? And it also have
might have effect on your tomography as well. So, and it related to the question that the Professor Ricardo did about the temperature measuring during the tomography test. I think if you can cross the differential scanning calorimetry analysis with your temperature parameter in tomography, you can get pretty good insights on that.
Okay. Nice.
I think it's muted again. Sorry, the professor.
Something is going on here, and I don't know what is it. Okay. So pretty much that was my comments and questions, like it's more exploratory, trying to understand your work better. So Murilo, so congratulations on your topic. Congratulations in your work. So you are doing it very well. I see that you are motivated. You are a motivated person. So and it's really, really nice to see it here. Thank you one more time for inviting me to be part of your committee, exam committee. And I think now we can finish here the evaluation part, right, Professor Pandolfelli?
Yes, yes. I have some few words to say, but
please, first
I would like to open to Professor Stefano if he would like to make some comments.
Oh, I think Stefano is muted, right?
Yeah, I can hear him.
Sorry, we can't hear. You can hear Professor Derek, sorry?
No, I can't.
Okay.
I'm not hearing Professor Stefano.
Yes, we're not capable of hearing you.
Yes, well, I can hear you.
You can? Oh, maybe it's an issue.
Me too. I can also hear very well.
Oh, sorry. I will try to enter with my phone, okay?
Please try to get in using the cell phone.
Yes, I can hear you.
Now I hear Murilo, but I still cannot hear Professor Stefano. But I mean, if other people are hearing them, go ahead.
You're hearing. I'm hearing.
I can hear you, but I'm not can I cannot hear the Stefano. Okay. Probably have to leave and enter again or not?
I think that I can make his comments just after.
Okay. Okay.
I think that Eric is not listening. Yes.
Yeah, I wasn't. Yeah, oh, okay. I can hear you, but Murilo. Okay, go ahead.
Okay. Professor Stefano, it was this sort of general comments that we were expecting. Of course, that we are part of work. We are not going to do some questions or to ask some questions to Murilo, because we have been doing that every day. Then, thank you very much. Thank you very much all for taking part of this exam. I would like to thank especially the members of the committee, Dr. Carlos, Professor Ricardo, and Professor Derek, Professor Stefano, for being so helpful. Professor Roberto Alzas, that please feel free to make some comments if you wish. I'm not quite sure.
Hello. I have no comments, just that I'm really enjoying interacting with Murilo a lot.
Okay. That. And I'd like to thank you very much for all the teaching on the mathematical part, and Murilo likes very much because he actually he has quite a lot of motivation to learn mathematics, and it's one of our consulting members of the group when you have problems with the mathematics. As it was mentioned, it's a teamwork because it's a multidisciplinary subject and it's very challenging. And what we would like to do here, it's not just to add another brick in the wall, but perhaps to build a new brick on the subject. It might be look a bit too much, and it is. But there is no way. Either we have this the whole team and perhaps some, we need some people from psychology as well to help all of us to cope with this pressure. But I'm quite confident that Murilo and the people that are coordinating this work will try to guide him for at least for the final text to focus and to present a very good work. Murilo is a very dedicated person. He's very talented. He is a hard worker. You can get in touch Saturday, Sunday, and he's always connected. And he needs different fronts at the same time. It's like those people that have such amount of energy that he cannot stay quiet. What is our role in that? It's to channel this energy and not in the case that not to be wasted. And so far, I think that it has been successful. It's progressing quite a lot. And as he mentioned, the point of working with such a large team is that each one of us has some sort of expectation. When you work with the mathematician, he works to go deep in that area. We work with material science. We have chemical engineer, physicist. We have aeronautic engineering. We have civil engineering. We have quite a lot of good experts. And of course, in the case of Dr. Carlos Pagliosa, he wants to see the application of that. Although he values, of course, the fundamentals, and he knows already that without them, you're not going to get to the right place and solve the practical situation. Then, congratulations, Murilo. Congratulations, and my deeply thanks for all the people that are involved or indirectly involved, and help of our team as well. And I'll finish my general comments and back to Professor Derek that we need to go to that private talking. I think that all of you received Murilo's link for this talk. It's a very, very brief talk, and we'll perhaps we'll be back very soon with the result. What seems obvious.
All right. So
thank you, Professor Derek.
Thank you, Professor Panofelli. So I would ask patience for the Professor Stefano and Murilo. We are moving to the private virtual room here. So we are going to argue some with evaluation. And then we'll be back in probably 5 minutes, I guess. Thank you.
Okay.
Hold
there. Then we are going to leave the meeting, Murilo, and we are going to be back to this link as soon as we finish.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'll see you, bye.
Bye.
All right.
Nossa, por algum motivo agora eu voltei para a sala e não consigo ouvir o Derek. Derek, fala alguma coisa.
Olá.
Eu vou sair, vou voltar de novo, um minuto.
Tá. Eu te ouço.
Eu estou conseguindo ouvir acho que todo mundo, mas não sei.
Todos estão me ouvindo?
Sim. Vou esperar o Ricardo novamente. Está me ouvindo aí, Ricardo? Não?
Eu estou ouvindo todo mundo.
Eu também estou
ouvindo. Talvez no celular, Ricardo?
Não, já está tudo normal.
Ah, perfeito.
Beleza.
Bom, então, Murilo, nós arguímos o seu trabalho, eu vou ler o parecer da banca, foi um parecer conjunto, tá? E eu vou ler agora para você. Vamos lá. O candidato apresentou seu trabalho dentro do tempo previsto, tá? De forma organizada, sucinta e objetiva. Durante a arguição, o candidato respondeu às questões de forma elaborada, demonstrando extensivo conhecimento nos tópicos envolvendo as áreas de estudo e entendendo as limitações da pesquisa. Destaca-se a completa abordagem do candidato ao problema proposto, visando um entendimento mais sistêmico do tema. Destaca-se também a capacidade do candidato em elaborar com pesquisadores, inclusive internacionais. Destaca-se a complexidade do tema de doutorado e a extensão dos objetivos do trabalho, que na maioria estão evidentemente adiantados e dentro do cronograma. Entretanto, a banca destaca a quantidade de objetivos propostos e sua avaliação quanto à finalização deles. Os comentários e recomendações feitos pela banca foram recebidos e compreendidos pelo candidato. Por essas razões, os membros da banca de qualificação recomendam a aprovação do trabalho de doutorado do candidato Murilo Moreira. All right. So, congratulations, Murilo. So, it's clear for us that you, as Professor Panofel said, you are a hard worker. So, I wish you the best of luck in your PhD. In your endeavor with Professor Stefano Laboratory. So I'm pretty sure that you're going to get amazing results there as you're getting in all your work. So congratulations.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Derek, and everyone from the examination board and also who collaborated. I think Professor Panofelli made it very clear. It's a team work, a team effort, and I am very proud and happy to be part of it. Thank you, Professor Panofelli, for the opportunity. Thank you very much.
All right.
Anyone thank you very much, all of you, Professor Derek, for coordinating this meeting, Professor Dalpon, for staying with us this time, not quite a long time, well, 3.5 hours. What it's normal for the qualification, but it's a bit difficult to stay tuned for such a long time without going at least to the toilet. But I think that all of us are released now. And thank you, Dr. Carlos. Thank you, Professor Ricardo. Thank you, Murilo. And congratulations. Murilo has a major task before going to Grenoble. He's going to get married.
Oh,
and hopefully that everything is going okay. I'm quite sure that some of you are not going to see personally before the end of the year. Then that all of you have a good Christmas time and a very healthy, wealthy, and peaceful 2023 for all of you. Brazil, it's a bit quieter now. We hope that it stays like that for the time being, and that 2023 for Murilo should be a very good and prosperous year. In his new life, now living together with his wife. All the best for all of you.
Thanks so much.
Bye. Thanks so much. Congratulations, Murilo.
Thank you.
Bonne continuation.
Oh my God.
Okay.
Thank you.
See you. Bye.
Nice talk to you, man.
Agora sim.